this, okay? Okay, the first question. The questions actually, some questions, a few questions, you know, by looking at the question, you would understood that there are asked from the economic survey. But if you read the economic survey, definitely questions like minimum wage, you will feel easier. But if you not read the economic survey, definitely you will not get any idea about how to write the question itself. Okay. And for example, the question number one is from economic survey. Before telling the answer, just let's discuss. The second one is the recent current affair. And then cashless economy, so it's not a very, it's a common topic. Then fourth one, very often this segment is asked in the UPSC. So same from the current affairs or economic or from static portion. Then next one is the 11th one. 11th one, you know, now it's a current topic. Yesterday almost the finance minister has come with announcement. And 12th one, it's almost since that our economy may get into recession in the near future. So this kind of questions may be asked. So you should have some idea about how to address the recession, or before our economy dips into recession, what should be done from the fiscal and the monetary fronts. Okay, that's the reason. Then 13th one may feel tougher for the people, those who have not read the economic survey, but this is a separate chapter in the economic survey. For example, you might be familiar with the words like data of the people, for the people, by the people. That's a chapter in economic survey. And then in that survey, they are exactly given how the, because that is an important a statement given by the Government of India in the economic survey. The statement is, in India, the marginal cost of marginal cost or the expenditure for the data is reducing, but the marginal utility for the data is rising day by day. For example, societal benefits, governance benefits, multiple angle. In that angle, the question has been asked. Okay, that's the reason for the 13th one. And then 14th one is the very common MDPI. And then now the thing is, not we all know about MDPI, but the question is about what is the merit of MDPI over the normal poverty. Okay, we'll look at the answer for all the questions. So the expected time is 45 minutes maybe for the my session, then followed by internal security, then agriculture, then science and tech. You won't be having discussion for the environment. The answer key will be sent to you. Okay, so I'll tell the answers. I prepared a detailed answer key for all the questions, so it will be sent to you. But the thing is, here you take the hints for the points. Okay, not waste your time, just you get the concept, how to structure the question, what should be done, what should not be done, what is the key areas. All the thing is in the statement form, clearly just formatted the key, so it will be sent to you. Okay, now the first one. The minimum wage system in India is complex, examine. So the question is about the complex nature of the minimum wage. It's not about, you should not write about what is the minimum wage and all. So the complex nature, that's the thing. It's a 10 mark question maximum. It's almost 4 or 5 points or 6 points. It's clearly given an economic survey. Okay, now we'll tell the content for the question. The point number one, before writing the point, you give the intro. What is the intro is, in the economic survey itself, the word is used by the Government of India. The minimum wage acts as the lighthouse for the governance. For example, you keep this a lighthouse. So what kind of the wage should be given? So the people are able to set some benchmarks based on the minimum wage set by the Government of India. And India is one of the first country among the developing nations to pass the Minimum Wages Act on 1948. Okay, now you take this intro. First point, you write the word lighthouse effect. The minimum wage concept, it acts as a lighthouse effect for fixing the minimum wages or the maximum wages in a society. Lighthouse effect. The next one, India is the first among the developing country. The Minimum Wages Act was passed on 1948. The minimum wage is some factual support. The first point. Okay, now let's do the analysis of the question. The question is about the examination. Okay, we have to examine the components. The first one. First thing, let us understand, then you can convert them into the point. Okay, first thing is, in India, there is a term called, not in India, commonly there is a term called as a scheduled employment, which means in the Minimum Wages Act, what are the employments which are listed in the schedule are called as the scheduled employment. But when you look at the scheduled employment nature of the minimum wages, in one state, the number of scheduled employment nature is almost 300 employments. They are categorized as the scheduled employment. But in another state, okay, they have got some different categories of scheduled employment, which means that in some, it starts from the level of 429 employments to the 1,100 employments. It differs from one state to state. So based on the scheduled employment nature, the level of minimum wages also varies from one state to state. So the entire scenario is, it's a complexity in the employment nature or the complexity in the coverage of the employments. Okay, that's the point number one. So you must understand the point. In some states, the scheduled employment number is some number. In another states, the number is large or lower than that. So we don't have the exact clear-cut idea what is the schedule, what is the meaning for the word scheduled employment. It's the point number one. Okay, right, the word complexity in the coverage. Scheduled employment is not exactly defined, so it differs from the state to state. And then the minimum wages, the same point, the minimum wages are prescribed based on the nature of job, nature of skill set, everything and all. This definition also varies from the state to state. That's the point number one. Complexity in including the scheduled employment and complexity in defining the job nature or skills, whatever may be. Okay, it's a point number one. So entire thing, you write the word as complex in coverage, detailed statement will be sent in the answer key. Okay, second one. For example, how do we fix the minimum wages? That's a question number two. To fix the minimum wages, certain states, what they are doing is they're linking the minimum wages with the cost of living, okay, or with inflation, and then they are coming into the terms called as a variable dearness allowance. But this variable dearness allowance percentage is not uniform across the states. It differs from the one state to another state, which means that complexity in the criteria, okay, what criteria you fix the minimum wages, it is not uniform across the state. That's a point number two, right? The point number two, complexity in the criteria of wage fixation. Complexity in fixing the criteria for wage. Complexity in the criteria. You just like the hints alone. Okay, the same. What I'm saying, everything will be to save the time. You'll be sent in the answer key. Complexity in the criteria. Third thing. For example, what is the range for the minimum? We are using the word as a minimum wage. So there must be some minimum wage. But when you look at the Nagaland, okay, the minimum wage in the state is 115 rupees. That's the minimum wage. But when you go to Delhi, the minimum wage as per the act is 538, which means that the minimum wage range itself varies from the 115 slab to the 538 from state to state, which means that there's a quite huge difference in the range of the minimum wages. It's a point number three. Complexity in the range. Complexity in the range. That's the third point. Okay, complexity in the range. Next one is the fourth point. What is the fourth point is here we are going to pitch about the word as inclusion. What is inclusion is here we got the act. Based on the act, we got the certain categories of jobs which are called as a scheduled employment. Okay, but in some states, domestic workers are included as the under the minimum wage category in some states. For example, in 18 states, they have included as the under the scheduled employment. But in the remaining states, they are not included under the minimum wages, which means that there is no proper uniformity in including all the sectors under the category. In some states, some jobs are included, some states not included, which means that you can come to the point is a complexity in the inclusion. Okay, it's not properly including all the segments of the people or the all employment categories. That's a point number four. Complexity in the inclusion. Okay, so this is the thing. Okay, when you elaborate this point, you will get almost about 10 points. Then the last what you can write is to remove all these things. What the government should do is we should have the uniform code across the states, which will ensure, and then everything must be inclusive. When bringing up all the points, when you make a conclusion, it becomes the answer for the question. Okay, so to have the better reading, you go to the economic survey. So the detailed answers will be sent to the key. Okay, it's the answer for the question number one. Okay, now let's go to the question number two, second one. Second one. Recently, RBI has made a decade-high surplus transfer to the government of India. Discuss the move. Actually, the question may appear very simple because it's a very common news which we all might have read in the paper. But when you try to write the answer, I think you'd have struggled to get the point. Okay, am I right? Because yes, I know about the content, what they are doing, but discuss the move means, so we may be struggle because certain things are very common, but when you try to draft them in the answer, we may struggle to avoid that because this question is asked. Now we'll discuss the answer for this question, okay? Because it has got some factual things, so let me pitch it in the board. So now thing is, first of all, you should give some intro for the statement. Recently, RBI has done a decade high surplus, so you should give the intro. What is a decade high surplus done by the RBI? Then we have to go for discussing the move, okay? Point number one, recently RBI has transferred 1.76 lakh rupees. You can say, you can give an intro as the 1.76 lakh crores were transferred by the RBI to the government. That's a recent, which is never in the past government has done this kind of, RBI has done this kind of transfer by to the government. So this seems to be a huge amount on the part of the RBI. That's a point number one. Now, so this is the intro. Now you can say, okay, now many people are arguing against this, but have some conceptual understanding. Don't write in the paper. The thing is, even the Urjit Patel resignation, okay, the previous issues, most of the things were based on this kind of the tussle between the RBI and the government, but don't bring them in the paper for idea. Okay, this is the thing. Okay, now after all the tussle, now a new governor is appointed. Now this governor has transferred this kind of amount to the government of India. Now we are going to discuss what this move is going to have the impact on the RBI, as well as on the government, as well as on the complete economy. Okay, now we're going to discuss the move. That's a question. What is the move? Is point number one. Let's start with the basics. What's the point? Is this money is a huge money, is going to be transferred by the RBI to the government. So it is going to address the fiscal issues on the part of the government. Okay, the fiscal demands of the government can be addressed by this kind of transfer. We are starting with the basic point. Let's go into the more conceptual point. Okay, at the point number one. Point number one is this helps the government to address the fiscal worries of the government. Point number one. Fiscal, because we know about the fiscal deficit, fiscal demands, so fiscal worries, point number one. Second point, we know that there is a rule called as FRBM. Government has stick on to the 3.3% of the FRBM target, but this money will definitely help the government to stick on to the 3.3, because it is the non-taxable revenue received for the government of India. Okay, try to include the same common terms in the new statements. Okay, so helps the government to stick on to the FRBM target of 3.3%. Okay, this is the additional revenue to the government of India. Okay, then you can write the third point. Third point is the most current point, but you should try to convert them into the point. Example, now we all understand that there is a scenario or expectation that economic recession may happen in the economy. So based on the line, this amount, when it gets transferred to the government of India, the government may utilize the money for the expansionary fiscal policies, which may help the economy to avoid the recession in the near future. Okay, there's a third point, to avoid the economic slowdown. Because now the need of the hour is the expansionary policy. For expansionary policy, government needs the money. This money comes at the right time by the RBI. Okay, this is the very basic points. Until now, we dealt about the basic points. Now, let's get into the most conceptual points of the move. Okay, point number one. Now, you know that when the tussle started between the RBI governor and the future, between the past RBI governor and the government appointed a committee, which we all know is called as a Bimal Jalan committee. Okay, now the Bimal Jalan committee has given some 3 points recommendation to the government of India. Okay, so the Bimal Jalan, previous RBI governor, okay, based on the committee has appointed, he has given some 3 recommendations. Point number one, point number two, point number three. Okay, now we're going to analyze whether the move done by the RBI is sticking on to the basic parameters suggested by the Bimal Jalan. Okay, now the point number one, Bimal Jalan stated that whatever money the RBI transfers to the government of India must be done only from the income or from the profits made by RBI, not from the reserves of RBI. Able to understand? Okay, so when you're transferring some income, it must be only from the profit, not from the extra reserve what you have. So that's the point number one. Okay, whatever the money you are transferring every year must be transferred only from the income or profits, not from the existing reserve what you should have. Okay, so that's the point number one, should only from the income or the profits, not from the basic reserve. Okay, so understand, it is not about the reserve. Okay, you have to stick on to certain reserve. Apart from that, you should not touch the minimum reserve what you should maintain. So apart from the minimum reserve, when you have the excess money, you can transfer. Okay, because the point what I'm saying should not be wrongly understood, because the second and third point I'm going to talk only about the reserve. What is the second point is, there is a concept called the contingency reserve. Contingency reserve is the money which must be maintained by the RBI to meet the operational and other issues, or credit risk, okay, market risk happens to the RBI. Further, what is the amount suggested, prescribed by the Bimal Jalan is the 5.5 to 6.5% of what means of total balance sheet. Okay, RBI's balance sheet, what is the total value? From the balance sheet, 5.5 to 6.5% must be the always kept as the contingency reserve. Okay, because there was a previous issue is the RBI was saying I should have this much amount of the contingency amount, but government saying why you are having this much amount. Okay, hereafter there won't be any confusion, because the thing is that we can easily check whether we are sticking on to this level or not. So 5.5 to 6.5 is the contingency buffer which must be maintained. Apart from this contingency buffer, when you have the retained earnings which can be sent from the, which means that this level money should not be transferred to the government of India. To understand this point, you connect this with the second point. Okay, now comes the third point. Third point is economic capital, which means that from the total balance sheet, there must be like the Basel norms. Okay, the RBI should also have some certain capital to support the RBI. What that's called as economic capital framework. Okay, so or simply it can be understood as economic capital. So this says that this Bimal Jalan committee says that there must be 20 to 24.5% of the total balance sheet, which must be maintained by the RBI as the total economic capital to support the RBI. Okay, so this money should never be touched. This money should never be transferred to the government of India. These are the three recommendations, 20 to 24.5% of the total balance sheet of the RBI. Okay, the three core points, understand. Okay, so understand this point, you should have the idea of the three points. Okay, now you will understand this point in a better manner. Okay, after having this much level, then whatever money you earn, you can transfer to the government of India. So you need not confuse. In the future, there won't be any tussle between the government of India and the RBI. Okay, this is the point number three. Okay, now we are going to discuss the move based on the three parameters. Okay, now this money government of India has transferred, RBI has transferred 1.76 lakhs. From the 1.76 lakhs, it's actually given in the two formats, 1.23 and then 52,600 something, say 637 or something crores, okay. So totally combined 1.76. This 1.23 lakhs goes to this zone, which means that it is considered as extra income transferred by the RBI to the government after having the minimum surplus. So which means that RBI has not violated the recommendation of the Bimal Jalan committee. So we are saying, yes, we are going by the rules. Okay, so it's a point number one. You can take down the point. Okay, first underwrite this, then you connect the point with the move done by the RBI. So the one, so actually 1.23 and 52 totally combined comes 1.76. This 1.23 lakh crore transferred by the RBI actually is the portion comes from the income. Okay, here in not being more factual, you can say 1.23 lakhs is transferred as a income component by the RBI to the government, which does not violate the Bimal Jalan committee recommendation, point number one. Second, here now they are given us some width, okay, range 5.5 to 6.5. here the RBI has made, RBI would have chosen this level also, okay, but RBI has chosen the 5.5 range of contingency, and after having this contingency, now the RBI is able to have the extra money of 52,000 crore. This amount has been transferred with RBI to the government of India. Even here also, imagine when the RBI has retained only 5.3%, okay, or if they retained only 4.9%, we can say that this transfer is not justified because they are not sticking on to the Bimal Jalan committee recommendation. But here we are complying with the norms or the recommendation given to the committee, so we cannot say this is a violation of the move done with RBI, point number two. Okay, so it's a technical points, all the points. Second point, right, it's almost 5.5. now the RBI is having the reserve. After having that money only, they're transferring the balance amount. Okay, now comes the third point. What is the third point? So you are saying that there should be economic capital to support RBI. That capital is the 20 to 24.5 crore. okay, but here the after transferring this much amount, now what is the capital retained by the RBI is the 23.3%. okay, here they are recommending for 24.5, but here the RBI has chosen the level of the 23.3%. so here also we are sticking on to the recommendation done by the Bimal Jalan. Okay, so in no way actually it hurts the recommendations of the done by the Bimal Jalan. In this angle, we discuss all the pros of the thing. Okay, but also there should be some concerns associated. Now what is the concerns? Okay, so here you should not write, this should not set some bad precedents and all, you cannot say, because it's not a precedence and all. Okay, they are functioning as per the recommendation, so it's not a bad precedence. Whenever they have some extra excess money, automatically will be transferred. Whoever is RBI governor, there won't be tussle. Okay, so in what way you can say is, now you have transferred this 1.23, okay, so this is the earnings what they done by the RBI. Okay, and here you have done the 52,000 crore is done, but here this 52,000 is done by the RBI, because now when the RBI is estimated to retain the contingency buffer at the level of 5.5, they are able to have extra 52,000, so they are able to transfer this much money to the government of India. Okay, next year they imagine that now they retain the 5.5. next year only when they are able to cross the 5.5, then only they could be able to transfer the money. So this cannot be expected by the government year after year. This may be considered only as a one time. Same amount when the RBI is not able to transfer, we cannot say that RBI is not able to make the RBI has not done that much profit like that. We cannot criticize RBI. Okay, so it's a two components. One is the income, second component is the capital. So this is mainly because RBI is able to transfer because RBI has maintained the 5.5%. The excess money the RBI has transferred. Okay, so in the next year when the RBI is wants to transfer, means only above this level RBI has got the able to build the contingency buffer, then only they can transfer. So year after after year. This could not be done by the RBI to the government of India. And then next point, okay, 23.3 is the level, okay, which means that, so next year they may go to the level of 22 or 21, 20. So lower the level means, so always the RBI should try to stick on to the maximum level. So if the RBI should not, when the economy is showing some downtrend, at that time they can keep go to the level. Example, in the Basel norms, should have the counter cyclical buffer and all. So in this angle, they can go, in the normal scenario, they should try to stick on to the upper limits prescribed by the above, okay. In this angle, write the move, okay. So all the points, only for technical purpose, I explain. From this point, we make them simpler and then write in the GES angle, you can write the point, okay. So this is a discussion of the move, which means that it is not a violation, okay. It is transferred and then going to help the economy in this angle. Apart from that, it seems to be one time exercise, this amount. But next year, government may also have the regular. So in the future, we won't be having any tussle between RBI and the government. There will be clarity of recommendation. Based on the clarity, whoever is the governor, they will do the transfer. So we won't be criticizing the government or either the RBI. In this angle, this move has made some clear clear for a clarity about the future transaction by the RBI. In this angle, you can conclude the answer. Okay, so this is the content for the second one. Almost this question is the most technical. The many things are, I think, most will be very easy. Okay, now comes the next one, is the third one. One by one. Definitely. What points you give me? No, Basel norms, what you're saying is for the banks. Basel norms you are bringing, you know, over the thing, whatever you can write, but how you are connecting the point. This economics is about the connecting the points. You can write whatever, but when you are able to link the point different manner, it justifies. But the thing is that it should be along with RBI and the government only. So you not bring the banks and all here and all, you not bring. Or when you are without bringing the banks, when you are able to make some connect, you tell me the point, I will try whether I can write or not. You are able to about. Which one? According to the? No, Basel III norms is the norm set only for the banks. Even for the Basel norm, what is the level we are saying? It's 8%, is a global level. For India, we recommend for 9%. But here, think about the level. It's more far beyond, okay? It is the, because that bank is involved in the lending activities. It's not the lending bank. The central bank. Central bank stability does not have, even the normal banks, when they have the stability, so there is no, there won't be any meaning associated with the instability of the RBI, okay, because it's more crucial than the normal banks. Yeah, this is a past case. So Brahma Jalan is a governor, okay. What you are trying to say is, in this angle, you're trying to critically examine and then you're trying to some criticize. But the question is only about discuss move. So the question cannot be in the negative angle. Don't pitch. Moreover, the question is about a tussle between the government and the RBA. So you try to take a neutral stand. So the point what you're trying to convey is, so this is a committee appointed by the government of India. So that the committee will recommend the things what the government expects. That's the point what you're trying to pitch. Okay. But here, don't bring the points. What I'm saying is, because you try to be a more, like you try to give the unbiased answer. Because it's a committee recommended government of India, so because your paper is going to be evaluated, and then, okay, so our objective, we are going to write the examination. So in this angle, okay, it's not right to bring that points and all in this answer. It's, that's why you discuss the move. Otherwise, you have given the answer, critical examine, or criticize the move. So that's why I not given the word critical examine, I given only the word discuss. So because you know the levels, no. Discuss this level, okay, examine, critically examine, you go to the level. I want you to go to only stick on to this level. Moreover, even the examination, if it is asked, they won't ask you to criticize the move. Only criticize the move means the point what you're saying, you can write. But here the question is only about discuss the move. That's also an economic angle. You discuss, don't bring any of the political things and all in this paper. So moreover, whatever paper, you try to be neutral, as much, even though there are some flaws are there. So in this angle, you try to be frame the point in neutral angle. Okay. Can be revised, okay, new committee, okay, in the future possibilities, or as per the law, things may happen. But here, it now, whatever rule we have, based on the rule, you try to justify your answer. Crowding out into Mari, crowding at Kondorla, Yedanalam, and the money RBI Kipona normally, imagine RBI is borrowing the money. Or RBI receives the, or not RBI, government receives the money. RBI receives the money, what is the impact? So whatever point you think, you can write here. But the thing is, try to bring the most technical points. Or if the question is 15 mark question, you can add more points. You can write. It's nothing wrong. The point what I say, you can write. அதான் அதான் என்ன சொல்லியிருப்பாங்க அப்படின்னா, சோ இங்க வந்து ஹியர் தேர் இஸ் அ பாயிண்ட், ஓகே, த ஜலான் கமிட்டி ஹஸ் டோல்ட் தட் த மணி மஸ்ட் பி டிரான்ஸ்பர்ட் ஒன்லி ஃப்ரம் த இன்கம், நாட் ஃப்ரம் த ரீவேல்யூவேஷன். ரீவேல்யூஷன் மீன்ஸ் வென் தே காட் சம் அசெட்ஸ், சோ வாட் ஐ வில் டூ மீன்ஸ் ஐ வில் ரீவேல்யூ த அசெட்ஸ், சோ த நோஷனல் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் த அசெட்ஸ் கீப் ஆன் இன்க்ரீசிங், விச் இஸ் நாட் த ரியலைஸ்ட் அமௌண்ட், விச் மீன்ஸ் இன் த புக் ஆஃப் அக்கௌண்ட்ஸ் ஐ வில் சே தட் மை 10 ருபீ அசெட் ஹஸ் வென் டு லெவல் ஆஃப் 20 ருபீஸ், ஓகே, சோ 20 ருபீஸ் வென் யூ பிரிங் த நோஷனல் அமௌண்ட், பேஸ்ட் ஆன் த நோஷனல் அமௌண்ட் த ப்ராஃபிட் சுட் நாட் பி டிரான்ஸ்பர்ட், ஒன்லி வென் த ப்ராஃபிட் இஸ் ரியலைஸ்ட் பை த ஆர்பிஐ ஒன்லி தட் அமௌண்ட் மஸ்ட் பி கிவன். So that point you can connect here, but don't write a separate point, okay? That's a word called as a revaluation reserves of RBA. Revaluation reserves must not be considered, okay? When I told I to use only about the buffer, it's only about the buffer. Revaluation reserves must not be considered. Only the real profit must be considered, okay? Okay, now shall we move on to the third one? So, okay. No, actually, Bimal Jalan is appointed by the RBI, but actually it was accepted by the government also. So in that angle, you can, if you want to be more specific, you can write the word RBI. So I didn't find that much there, I didn't give the importance, so I would use the word government. But if you want to be more technical, regarding the committee is not about the question. When you want to bring the point, you can change the word, you can write as RBI. So it's only because when the government is not appointed, they would not have went on. Because even the RBI governor is now supporting the government. There is no tussle based on the current scenario. So that's why I told you can just mention only about the core point. Closing is not required, but if you want to correct that, you can correct. இல்ல அதெல்லாம் நம்ம அதெல்லாம் அந்த அது முடிஞ்சு தானே இங்க வந்திருக்கு. ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஃபர்ஸ்ட்ல இருந்து உங்க கேள்வி ஆரம்பிக்கிறேன். அப்படி பைண்டிங் சொல்ல இது கேன் பைண்ட், இட்ஸ் கால்ட் ஆட்டோனமஸ் பாடி நோ. So when they are not doing, then the government will implement the section 47 or whatever may be, okay, based on that they will excise the thing, okay. So adhu inge kondra vendidilla, critical examine what made the discuss the move means okay, discuss the move alone itself. So what necessitated the RBA in that angle we can go, but it's not required for the 10 mark question. So when you don't have points, you can go for the move, but here you got some adequate points. So I think more than okay, 2 pages we got the points. When you don't have the points at the time, you can try to fill the paper, you can say what made the RBI to go. So this committee is appointed and all, you can write. So now the third one, define cashless economy, explain the benefits and hurdles in implementing the cashless economy in India. Very simple. What is cashless economy means? It's economic structure where you don't use any physical cash. Everything will be digital or online, electronic. Only the debit card, credit cards is called as a cashless economy. Okay, that's the basic definition. Okay, so all structures will be digital. Nothing will be, the paper currency will not be used in the economy itself. That's called as a 100% digital economy. Okay, next point, explain the benefits and hurdles in implementing this implementing the cashless economy. First you tell me the benefits of cashless economy. Very simple. First you can write these results in the cost reduction. When you are doing everything in cash form, okay, the printing of money, storing of money, disseminating the money, or the transporting the money, everything requires huge amount. Government can save huge money in the going digital. That's a point number one, cost reduction for the government of India. Point number one. Second thing, it is very convenient. Okay, for example, when everything is in a cash form, okay, when you have to withdraw the money, everything, okay, everything in cash form means you cannot do the transaction after a certain time. For example, when all the shops gets closed by 9 o'clock, after 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, you cannot do the transaction. But any time, okay, even at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, midnight, you can do the transaction. So any time it's more convenient, you can stay at home, you can do the transaction. So it's a very convenient form. That's the benefits of the implementing the. So question is about the implementation, okay, not about the thing. So implement the benefits of implementing. Point number two. Third point, you can track all the transactions. You not in the economy angle. You can track all your spends, tracking the spending. What you are doing, everything can be spent. Okay, tracking the spendings. So that's point number three. Okay, in the online transaction goes means the money goes to the system. So you can track the spendings, and based on the point, you can say this will make the economy more formal. Or you can write it as the next point, because question is only about explain the benefits, so it's not discussed, so the same thing can be can lead to the next point. Okay, they may make the economy more formalized. Okay, it's the next point. Then apart from that, you can write the fourth point, risk reduction. What is the meaning of the word risk reduction in the point? Risk, exactly. Okay, when I'm carrying the money in the cash form, the money may get stolen. Okay, money may be lost in the midway. Okay, but when doing the online transaction, the money is the risk is very less. Okay, the people, because there is a common saying during the earlier days and all, when you did the transaction in the physical form, the physical strength was required to carry the money. For example, when I carry the 2 lakhs, I should be strong enough, or 2 or 3 people should accompany me. Okay, but now even I have the 10 lakh or 10 crore in my account, who knows? Okay, well, so only my card knows the okay, because no one knows that I have that much money, because in the earlier days you used to carry the form money in the bags, so which means that complete risk reduction. Okay, anyone can carry the money. Okay, it's the most safer form. Risk gets reduced. There is no chance of theft. But here also, you can argue me, sir. The money may get stolen in the cyber threat and all. That we'll see in the hurdles. Okay, next angle. Okay, here I'm telling about the benefits. Apart from the fifth one. So the, now the current scenario, it helps the government to improve the tax base. Tax base, because the money comes to the system, you can track all the things, so the government can bring a tax, bring under the tax bracket, so the tax base. And the fifth one, sixth one, it makes the economy more inclusive. Okay, so all the people, for example, targeting, avoid the corruption, example DBT, you can bring. Okay, it makes the economy more inclusive or corruption free. Imagine the, imagine, okay, after tomorrow government makes announcement, okay, hereafter in India no money should, no transaction take place in the cash. So what will happen? Imagine, even for the 10 rupees, even for 100 rupees, you cannot spend the cash, means what will happen? So the issue is people don't have the kind of literacy and the other things. But when the economy and the people, and our society has got that kind of setup, government makes announcement, everything should be made only in the digital format. Okay. So what the people will do with the money, what they earned through the illegal means, okay, they cannot bring them the money system itself. Okay. So only the legal money will be the valid money system. So in this angle, this makes the economy more inclusive, or less corruption. Okay. So more economic development. Everything can happen. Sixth point, okay. Then you can write, okay, the thing is, the based on this point, you can write, this eliminates the parallel economy in the parallel economy. So parallel economy, all the illegal transaction cannot happen because nothing is cash. So money should come to the system or the bank. So this makes the economy more more legal. So avoids the parallel economy. Now the hurdles. In India, when we are trying to implement this cashless economy, question is about implementation. So what are the drawbacks? Is point number one, in India, we don't have the proper literacy among all the people. Okay, many people are quite enough able to understand, but it's not, that's not the case with the all the people. Okay, we got the digital divide among the people. Okay, digital literate and digital illiterate. So digital divide. And second one, you can write digital divide is one angle based on literacy. Second angle, you can write in the rural divide because the people not having the proper connectivity issues. Okay. So second point is a rural divide. So regarding the connectivity, we are bringing the point. It's a rural divide. Then third point, in India, even now, 90% of the transactions are cash-based transaction. Okay. From 90%, okay, which means that only 10 is cashless. From 10, when you want to make them as 100%, okay, it will take some years for the government. In India, even now, based on the data, 90% of transactions are the cashless transaction. It's very hard. Okay. Fourth one, apart from that, most of the employment nature are informal in India, even agriculture or in the MSME sector. All the transactions are done only in the cash form. So converting everything into the digital form, okay, it will take some time. Okay. So the thing is, the most of the jobs are informal in nature. And then comes a very important point, most important point, cyber threats. Cyber threats or cyber awareness. Okay, people does not have the proper awareness. Okay, so how we should secure, for example, even if we all know that we should not give the password, nothing to the people. Okay, but even now we got regular cases. Okay, someone made a call, okay, gave all my password. Even now it's a quite common phenomena, which means that the cyber threats, okay, apart from the phishing, everything, okay, even the small, easily they're able to trap the people. Okay, so these are the benefits and hurdles. It's a very simple question, very direct question. Okay, now let's go to the next one. Here the thing is, you need not write about the schemes, what is the digital schemes we have in India, nothing is required. Question is very simple, define cashless economy, explain the benefits. Here I just written about the things, okay, you can explain them in one or two lines, okay, only about explain, not about the schemes and policies what we have, that's not asked in the question, only stick on to the benefits and stick on to the hurdles in implementation, okay. You know, trying to implement, apart from the point what I told, you think that some other points are regarding, we have as a hurdles in economy, you can write, bring them also in the points. Okay, these are the contents. Okay, someone asked something. So are you talking about the money multiplier or money multiplier? Even in the bank transaction, same money multiplier. How it will go to beneficiary, because it is a money charged by the concerned service provider. Imagine you are a person who is running a company. No, it cannot be called as a middleman. Middleman is different, service provider is different. Okay. because middleman we eliminate, system may function, but the service provider when eliminate, system will collapse. Okay, imagine you are willing to start some digital platform which will enable that digital transaction. Okay, even imagine take the payment banks. Now very often it's coming, payment banks are not able to make huge profits. Why? Because what may be the business model for the payment banks? Or take any digital service provider. Okay, is enabling you to do all the transaction in the online format, but is not charging you. Okay, you are benefited, everything is going fine for you, you are getting the offers, cash reward, everything. Okay, but what may be the economic benefit for the concerned service provider? Okay, he got the office institutional structure, he got digital structures, he has to pay the salary to the people. Okay, where they'll get the money? Imagine then, for example, when they are charging more, you can ask, okay, but when they are charging for 2 rupees, 3 rupees, that's the money what we are liable to pay for the people, those are giving the service. That's the rule of, that's a basic rule. No, you go to a shop, when you're asking for a shampoo or a soap, okay, we'll give money and get shampoo. Okay, same angle when you're getting digital services, so we have to pay money, but what the government will is trying to do is, so all the merchandise people, even after that, they are giving many merchandise discount, many offers they are giving. So I think your point is not that much, does not have that much issue. Because the thing is, when you imagine that, okay, you know, in the digital world, everyone, we are aware of that. When you are not paying money, okay, some people are giving offers, everything, okay, because we know about the mechanism behind the offer, okay. So what they are getting in turn is the nothing but they are getting our data, nothing but, okay, because you know that data is the money what we are paying, but we are not concerned about giving our data, but they are very highly concerned about giving 10 rupees, okay. Our data is much more costlier than the 10 rupees, okay. So in that angle, all the apps or all our service provider, when they are giving something free, definitely thing is that they are getting something in return, okay. Nothing is free in this commercial world. Okay, so I think that's the logic. Now we all know about it. So we cannot blame the people when they are charging some nominal amount. That's the thing that should be done in the economy. Okay, that we cannot stop. We can stop means then government should involve. Government should provide all the service. Then once again we have to go back to the 1991, the era of the everything by the government, everything, okay, of the government, for the government. We have to go. Okay, it's difficult. Okay, next one. The fourth one, how does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate in India? Give reasons and explain the consequences. Okay, now the question, let's decode the question. How does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate in India? Give reasons and explain the consequences. Okay, here the what error you may commit in the paper is, how does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate in India? It seems to be a simple question, but there is a small trick in the question. What is the thing is, how does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate? Imagine, okay, the question is ended with the word, how does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate means, you can say balance of trade is the balance, it will end up in the neutral. Balance of trade is a positive, it may lead up the appreciation. Balance of trade is a negative, it may go to the depreciation. Okay, but the question is about the how does the balance of trade affect the exchange rate in India. So you have to write what is the Indian scenario. You should not write in general, okay, because you have to understand question. When I take the word in India, the question will be different answer. Okay, but the question is about in India. So what is India's balance of trade, how does it affecting the foreign exchange rate? Okay, so first you understand the general picture. Balance of trade, it includes only export and import of goods and goods alone. So there is a two scenario. It may be balanced, which means that no impact. Impact, no impact means inflow, outflow will be equal. So there is no appreciation, no depreciation. But balance of trade, when goods go surplus, will get more money than the outflows. Automatically, currency will appreciate. Okay. Third thing is the balance of trade goes negative means automatically currency will depreciate. That's a not. Okay. But here you should not confine your answer with the balance of trade, because balance of trade is not a separate component. It is the integral part of the concept current account of India. So what you should do is balance of trade, you have to connect it with the current account. So in what way current account gets affected because of balance of trade, because of the current account damage, and what way the foreign exchange rate gets affected. Okay, very simple. We all know that balance of trade in India. So and then balance of trade plus invisible makes the account called as the current account of India. Okay, we all know that in India the current account deficit is almost 2.4%. Okay, so current account deficit, previous year it was around 1.8%, before that it was around 0.6 or 0.8. okay, in this angle India's current account deficit is rising every year. Why means? Because India's balance of trade is going in the deficit zone every year. For example, even the last year the balance of trade level was 4.926% of India's GDP. Okay, so because of this increase, balance of trade is making the impact on the current account. This is the understanding what you should have. Okay, now how you should write the answer for the question is, the question is about how does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate. Okay, so the balance of trade, how it is affecting the foreign exchange rate, means balance of trade is negative. Because of negative, more money is going out of India. Because of that, current account is resulting in deficit zone. Okay, because of deficit, India's actually, what is happening is India has to pay more dollars than the dollars what we receive. Because of the paying more dollars, India's facing the buying pressure on dollar. India is having the selling pressure on rupee. Because of the buying pressure on dollar, so what is happening is dollar is raising and Indian rupee is coming down. Okay, that's the foreign exchange rate. Okay, so what connect is, so you have to understand with the current account deficit, and because of the balance of trade, India's current account deficit is coming down. So now the value is 2.6. because of that, more money is going out of India. Because of, when the more money goes out of India, automatically what will happen is the currency will depreciate. Okay, this is the reason. Okay, so the thing is, first you write how does the balance of trade affect the foreign exchange rate. Means balance of trade in India is always in deficit. Because of that, the currency is affecting the, making the currency to go to the depreciation. It is depreciating the currency. That's the point number one. Second thing is, give reasons why the currency is depreciating. Means reasons, you can say the point what I told. Okay, for example, balance of trade leading to the current account deficit. Because of current account deficit, more money is going out of India. So the buying pressure on dollar and selling pressure on rupee, this makes the currency to go down in India. That's the reason. Now let's write the answer. Consequences of the depreciation. What are the consequences of depreciation? You should be, it's a very, very simple point. Okay, what's the point number one? When the currency depreciates, automatically the point number one, what we have all know is the, it promotes the exports in a country. Point number one. Okay, first you write the points. First you write the exchange rate. The first answer for the first line is depreciation. Okay, first line. Second is the reasons. What is the reason? Is the balance of trade deficit, current account deficit, more dollar outflow, and then depreciation. That's the reason why the dollar depreciates. Means more dollar is going out of India. Okay, next one is the consequences. Explain the consequences. Point number one, it depreciation favors the exports. So based on the first point, automatically comes second point. What makes the second point? It makes the imports costlier. Second point, imports costlier. Then third point, it reduces the foreign exchange reserves of our country. Forex reserves, third point. Fourth point. Okay, now when the currency depreciates, what will happen to the money value of the country? Imagine India's currency going to 60, 70, 80, 90, what will happen? It affects the money value of rupee, so it affects the, so next point is the money value of rupee gets, money value of the particular currency gets affected, or in Indian currency, okay, you can write, money value of rupee gets affected, fourth point. When the money value of rupee, Indian rupee gets affected, what will happen? So I'm saying the point to connect to the next point. What inflationary pressures will emerge in the economy? This may lead to inflationary pressures. When the inflation happens in the economy, what will be done by the RBI? Consequences. When the, imagine, okay, Indian rupee is going 60, 70, 80, 90. What will happen? Okay, we'll be having inflation in the economy. So what will happen? They'll raise the interest rate in the economy. So interest rate will be raised in the economy. So this makes the borrowing or the investment costlier in the economy. So the borrowing will become more costlier because interest rates are raised by the banks. So the borrowings or the investments will become costlier in the economy. So this affects the economic growth of the country also. So this is the, within the country. Okay, apart from the country, outside the country, what will happen? Whether the foreign investors will come to India or they leave India during depreciation. They will leave India. That's called, what's the term we can coin? Flight of capital. Okay, the money outflow. You can write the word flight of capital. The money goes out of India, flight of capital. Then one more point, you write the outside the country. Okay, when currency depreciates, what will be the strength on our side? The two things you understand. Now, with based on the question, we are talking about depreciation. So because of depreciation, what is happening? Okay, but when the currency appreciates, what will happen? I think in the previous test, we discussed the answer. Okay, when the currency appreciates, what will happen is our government will have good rating on the external market. Because of good rating, we could be able to issue the sovereign bonds. Okay, but during depreciation, what we could be able to do? Okay, we could be able to issue masala bonds in the foreign country. Okay, so the consequence is India may be forced to issue masala bonds in the foreign country. Appreciation, sovereign bonds. You just understand the connection. Okay, sovereign bonds, depreciation is a masala bonds. Based on the point, based on the same masala bond, you can write one more point also. What is the point is there? India's credit rating will get decreased in the overseas market because of Indian rupee depreciation. Okay, not a stable currency. So our rating will get downgraded. Okay, based on the rating downgrade, what point you can write? Okay, when the rating gets downgraded, India may be forced to issue the securities at the higher interest rates in the foreign country. These all are the consequences. Okay, from the point you can write 4 or 5 points is more than enough, but have all the points in your kitty. You make the connection based on that, you can sketch your answer. Okay, so this is the thing. So how does the balance of trade affect the exchange rate? Then reasons for the exchange rate depreciation, then consequences. Okay, only these things must be in the paper. Okay, the 3 segments. Now let's move on to the next one. 11th one is a very simple. I think you'll be having bundle of points. Everyone will be having 11th one. Very simple. NPA issues has made the bank merger inevitable to the government of India. You write some in NPA issues in India. Most of the public sector banks, very often they got more NPAs than the private sector banks. So it is becoming inevitable. It has become inevitable to the government of India to get merger. And then you can write some examples. State Bank of India merger and Dena Bank merger, Vijaya Bank merger. And now you got the current affair is the bank. India, all the 27 banks will become the 12 banks. In this angle, you can write the points. Okay, these are the examples for the merger. Then the question is, what is the rationale? What is the benefits? What is the challenges? First, you tell me, what is the rationale behind the merger? Right? The heading is rational. What is the logic based on which they merge the banks? Point number one. First one. Okay, what is the logic behind the thing is the easy to monitor. Okay, when you have less number of banks, easily you can monitor the banks. That's the rationale, not the benefits. Easy to monitor. Okay, that's the logic. Easy to monitor. Second point, easy to provide the capital support. Capital support, that's the rational. Easy for the government to provide the capital support to the government, to the banks. The recapitalization, everything and all, may be easy in the future. Third one, because of the monitoring, NPA may get addressed. That's the main reason, okay, NPA, okay. The NPA issues may get addressed in the near term. This is the rationale. Now let's look at the benefits. What are the benefits for the NPA issues? Anyway, benefits for the bank merger, right, the benefits. Point number one. India will get the largest banks. Okay, for example, it is a large banks. For example, the global level banks may emerge in India. The largest banks or larger banks may emerge. Second point, increase in the customer base may create large banks. That's the point number one. Second point, increase the customer base of the banks. Imagine that the banks are merged in such a way, North Indian Bank, South Indian Bank, like in that angle they are merging. So customer base may increase. Based on the same point, again, third point, North Indian Bank merges with South Indian Bank. What is the thing is the pan-India presence. Okay, pan-India identity. Pan-India presence. Example, you can take many banks. Punjab National Bank is quite dominant in the North India, okay, and the Vijaya Bank in the South India. Okay, when these banks and all merge, automatically, okay, you'll be having the pan-India identity. Fourth point, it improves the operational efficiency of the banks. It enables the banks to provide the multiple products and services to the customers. And easy for the government to provide the capital support. The same point. Once again, the point gets repeated. These are the benefits. Now we write the next one is the challenges. What is the challenges? We have to comply with all the pre-merger formalities. That's the point number one. Okay, comply with all the formalities. That's the point number one. So complying with the pre-merger formalities. Second point, integration of different culture, two different cultures. Okay, the personals and the working culture or the business culture, lending culture, whatever may be. Okay, two different bank, two different thing. Okay, integration of culture and management of personal. Okay, then third point, to sustain the future of the bank as well as the employees. Example, to prevent from downsizing, these things should not happen. Okay, sustain the future of the banks, and the bank's profit also should not come down after the merger. Sustain the future of the bank as well as the employees. Fourth point, it's a very common point. We all always know that. Okay, so the thing is the in mathematics, okay, alone minus, okay, and multiply the minus, this will become a plus. Okay, but normally, okay, only plus multiply the plus, only the answer will be minus. Okay, but here what strategy we are following? Okay, here weak bank, government is merging with a strong bank. Okay, so even in the mathematics, the concept is a minus into plus. What will happen is the multiply, this will become minus, but government thinks that negative bank, weak bank with a strong bank will be positive for India. This is the controversy, which means that a strong bank, is a bank merged with a weak bank, When it erodes the profitability or the commercial viability of the strong bank means, that's a question what we have in the future. So which means that merging a bank is not a bad idea, but a bank with an NPA issue gets merged with a strong bank, it may shake the financial fundamentals of a strong bank. That's the biggest hurdles. This should not happen. Okay, we must be very cautious. That's an important hurdle what we have. So write the point as a merging a strong bank with a weak bank may affect the financial fundamentals. And then apart from that, the next point is the maybe simple point. For imagine that I have an account in the Vijaya Bank. Okay, now next my brother is having an account in the Dena Bank. Okay, now the two banks gets merged. So what now? Imagine my account will be having different IFSC number. Okay, so and then my account number will be different. Now my account number should be changed. Everything should be changed. Okay, how we are trying to communicate to all the customers. Okay, because it's not. And then sometimes some people are even now using the checkbooks. Okay, so checkbooks from the UCO Bank. Okay, checkbooks from the Vijaya Bank must get changed to the Punjab National Bank. Means all the people must submit the old checkbook. The address must be verified by the bank. Okay, to the new address you have to issue all the things. Okay, it is not an easy process. It's a very lengthy process. Okay, this will take very long time for the banks to complete all the things. Okay, so it is the post-merger formalities. First we told about the pre-merger formalities, then is the post-merger formalities. Example, the communication and all the things. Okay, this may take more time for the banks. So that's the last point. So these are the issues associated with the merger of the banks in India, benefits and then hurdles. Now the next question, very simple. What is meant by economic recession? Explain how effectively monetary and fiscal policies can be used to address it. Question is about how effectively, so which means that all the points, because it's a very simple question, but the scoring lies in how you are connecting the point with the addressing the recession. Okay, take for example monetary policy, a simple strategy, how it will affect the recession. In this angle, all the connectivity must be in your answer. Okay, now let's look at the points. What is meant by recession? First you tell me what is meant by recession. We all know about downturn, but when we call an economy has fallen into recession. What is it? There are many indicators. Among the main indicators is the GDP growth of the country. Okay, and what stage we'll call the country has got into recession? When we'll call? Growth slowdown. We all know growth slowdown. What is the exact technical slowdown? What is the slowdown? When? But imagine that my economy is last year it was around 7. Last month it was 7%. Okay, last quarter. This quarter is around 6.5. Shall I call this a recession? No. Okay, now next quarter is around 4.5. Can I call it a recession? No. Next quarter is around 1.5. Can I call it a recession? No. Then when will I call recession? So it go to the negative level. Okay, it should go to negative level. For example, below 0, okay, minus 1 or the minus 0.5, minus 2. That should also happen for the two consecutive quarters. Okay, which means that minimum two consecutive quarters it must go. Then only we call, yes, economy has got into recession. Minimum consecutive, not months, minimum consecutive quarters, which means a minimum halfway. Okay, minimum halfway there must be a downturn. Along with that, all the other data must also support. There must be a collapse in the market. The foreign money should go out to India or economy. Inflation will rise. Why the inflation means value for the money is going down. And then job data will be negative. All the things will be combined. Then only we come to conclusion. Yes, economy has got into recession. But the foremost point is this point. Okay, so the minus economic growth for the consecutive two quarters. If write the basics, what is meant by economic recession? Because we are very often the news is that after 8 months or 10 months, the global economy, even Indian economy, may get into recession. Okay, we got recession worries. So all the government is trying to address recession. Okay, so from their maximum possibilities of addressing. So we should have some understanding what could be done in this scenario. Now the question, next segment is, explain how effectively monetary and fiscal policies can be used to address it. First is the monetary policy, how what way we can use. Very simple, the policies which are used by the monetary authority to avert the recession are called as the easy money policy. The policies used by the fiscal authority to avert the recession is called as the expansionary policy. So the question is about the, they asked you to explain about the easy money policy and then about the expansionary fiscal policy. Only this is a contest. Okay, so I'll tell you the point. This point you just explain in the paper. Okay, first, what is the easy money policy done by the Reserve Bank of India? Very simple one. Point number one. We all know the most important tool is the repo rate, bank rate, everything. You convert them as a point. What is the point? They will lower the interest rate in the economy, definitely. That's the thing done by Fed and even by the government of India. What they'll do, they'll bring down to 3%, 2%, 1%, 1.5%. So whoever wants the loan, you try to borrow and then invest so that country will not fall down. Okay. The point is a lower interest rate. So how we can write them is a lower interest rate, which will enable the people to borrow and then to make the investments in the economy. You can, question is about explain. Okay, in the angle, you make one or two line. Okay, need not go much in lengthier explanation and all. Second point. So lower interest rate, then what is the other point? One is the interest rate. When you go to the money class, monetary policy, what you understood, okay? For example, reserve requirement. What is reserve requirement? CRR, SLR, what they will say? You need not maintain 4%, maintain 3.5%, maintain 3%, maintain 1.5%. So that is called as a lowering the reserve requirements. Point number two, lowering the reserve requirements. Lowering the reserve requirements. Enable the increase of cash flow into the economy or injection of money supply to the economy. That's a point number two. And then before that, okay, now we all know that, okay, these two points will end up in where they'll end up. Will end up in the increasing money supply, but make them a separate point because it's a separate word, okay. RBI tried to increase the money supply in the economy. RBI will try to increase the money supply and then money multiplier in the economy. In that angle, you can bring, okay, money multiplier, because you know that when the reserve goes down, what will happen? Money multiplier keep on increasing, okay? Higher reserve, low multiplier, lower reserve, higher multiplier. In that angle, you can explain, okay? Increase the money supply in the economy. Then why the RBI is doing all the things? Because you know that the monetary policy is based on the the particular center, that's the central focus of the monetary policy. What is the point is there? RBI will try to increase the demand or bring down the demand. That's the reason, okay? When you increase the demand, automatically what will happen? The inflation will happen in the economy. When you bring down the demand, automatically everything goes down, okay? So here, what will be the objective of the economy? Because economy is going down. We should make the economy to function, okay? What will happen? Revive. Revive is the engine, is the demand. Demand is the fuel, okay? So what they will try? They will try to increase the aggregate demand in the economy. Increase the aggregate demand in the economy. Because demand is the essence. Because demand is the driver of an economy. So they will try to increase the aggregate demand. Then, okay, the very simple point. What is the point is there? So securities which are sold by the RBI will be brought back. Will be, okay, they will buy back. Okay, so that the money supply will be increased by the RBI. In this angle, you can write. That's a very simple point. Anyway, the money supply you can connect. But when you don't have the points, you can write them a separate point. Securities. And then comes the last point. What is the last point is there? You know that RBI monetary policy made up of two segments. One is the quantitative policy. One is the qualitative. Okay. Quantitative is all about the numbers, interest rate, CRR, securities, everything, okay? Qualitative, what we are doing, direct action, okay, everything there, what we are doing, the thing is the RBI is giving some moral instructions to the banks, okay, which means that regulatory norms, RBI make them rigid or make them flexible, which means that they won't take out the rules, okay? The rules will be flexible to enable, facilitate, so you can draw, bringing down the regulatory requirements, okay? They'll slow down regulatory, okay? For example, the PCA framework, whatever rules, okay? They'll try to stick on to the framework, but they try to make them flexible. So you can write the point, bringing down the regulatory requirements to trigger the economy. So these are the monetary points, okay? Now we write the fiscal points. So not the same points, but the opposite angle we're going to write the point. What is the fiscal angle? Very simple. Point number one, what the government will do when the economy goes down? First thing is the government will reduce the tax rates in the economy, okay? That's an ordinary recession. So the tax rates, reducing the tax rates. Reducing the tax rates in the economy. So the people will have some money. The money will get invested by the people. Okay, then the economic growth. Next one. What the government will do? Subsidies. Government will provide all form subsidy to the primary sector, secondary sector, all the sectors. They'll try to induce the money supply in the economy, subsidies. Then third point, government will increase the spending. Or government may get involved in the printing of money. Okay, money or deficit financing, okay, for productive expenditure, capital expenditure, not for the revenue expenditures, okay? So government spending, government will increase. Next point, what the government will do? Government will conduct a meeting, they'll discuss all the people, commerce minister, finance minister, prime minister, will discuss what they'll do, okay? Now we have got some stringent rules in economy, let's liberalize the rules so that the more people will come with the money into the economy, they'll invest in the economy, so which will trigger the growth, which means that they'll make the flexible policies. Why flexible policy means, next point, to attract more investments to the economy, this should be done, okay? So now all the measures, what we are doing is trying to avoid the recession, okay? Fifth point is that to make economy friendly policies, okay? So economy friendly policies. And fifth point, government will try to attract more investments. Government will try to attract more investments. Okay, these are the fiscal side. Okay, printing money, okay, our government may do for the capital expenditures. Or you can write, government will increase the capital investments in the country. Government will increase the capital or productive investments from their side. Not from the private side. Government will try to increase. Okay, so in this angle, And then even the government, now the sovereign bonds move itself, because government does not want to crowd out the privates. That's why we are trying to borrow the money from the other country. In this angle, we'll do all the things. Okay. Then you frame the points, automatically you'll get the 15 mark content for this question. Okay. Increase in depreciation. Depreciation. What you are trying to convey or ask? Depreciation of currency you are asking, of assets you are asking? That's okay. That's a point, but actually that's a statistical measure. Imagine that when I say that this TV has got depreciation of the 1%, what I'll do means I try to have the same TV for the 100 years. But I say TV has got depreciation of the 20%, what I'll do, in 5 years, I'll feel the TV has got worn out. I'll try to replace the TV with a new TV, which will enable the purchase activities. Okay, but actually that's a statistical measure. Okay, that's, it cannot be, maybe a minor point, but it's not going to be known by the people in that angle. Depreciation is a kind of the tricky disguise what the government is doing. It won't be that much followed by the government. Okay, you know, you not bring that point enough. No, stagflation is what you're saying, but stagflation we won't call them as a recession. Stagflation. Okay, so actually in the recession period, we won't be having that much inflation. Recession period, we'll be having the deflation because there is a lack of demand. Deflation coupled with the slowdown economic growth. When the inflation coupled with the slowdown economic growth, we call them as a stagflation. So normally in recession period, we'll be having deflation. When you have the inflation, that's not the real recession. So we have the terms now, deflation, disinflation, stagflation. Recession, we won't be having inflation worries. Inflation will be having, inflation worries will come at the end. Why? Means economy will all the areas economy will lose the hope. So the value of the money will come down. At that time, there won't be production possibilities. All the industries will get shut, okay? So there will be lack of supply. Because of supply, at the end, it will be having the inflation. Initially, there won't be having inflationary pressures. So this is the, in that angle, it will be having some gradual phase will get built up in the, which will lead us to a recession. அது தனியா ஸ்டாக் பிளேஷனா வச்சிருக்கோம்ல. ஸ்டாக் பிளேஷன்றது மேபி ஸ்லோ டவுன் எக்கனாமிக் க்ரோத். இட் கேனாட் பி கால்ட் அஸ் அ ரிசெஷன், பிகாஸ் இன் ஸ்டாக் பிளேஷன் டைம்ஸ் யூ காட் இன்ஃபிளேஷன். When you have inflation means only when you have demand, okay? So what will have means that because the demand is there, so the stagflation may get reversed anytime. But recession will not reverse. Recession may lead to depression. Just stagnation combined with inflation. Yes, supply. Because the stagnation, because the economy got stagnated. Why? Because lack of supply. That's all, okay? But here, it's not about lack of supply. It is about whatever you are producing, supply will be there, but there won't be demand for the supply what you have produced. So as a manufacturer, now imagine automobile sector is having downtrend, okay, which means they don't have the supply. They have, but the people don't have the demand. But the automobile sector is not the recession concept. It is leading to us to the recession. We got many the Bharat Stage 6 norms, electric vehicles, that's other reason. But when the economic things makes the economy to go follow the downtrend, then we call them as a recession. Okay. Next question is the 13th one. Okay, I think people, those who read economics, sir, would attended. Other people would not have attended the question. What is meant by data infrastructure? You tell me. What is the data infrastructure? What is the meaning for the word infrastructure? What have you interpreted? Data infrastructure. Very simple. You know about infrastructure. Okay. For example, imagine I got a system or I got a mobile. In mobile, I'm writing all my activities or my data. I'm writing in the mobile. Okay. So that's the infrastructure where I'm keeping my data. Okay. In this angle, or else imagine that I got some accounts ledger. Okay. In a notebook, manual notebook. Okay. In the manual notebook, I'm writing all my data. What is the credit? What is the receipt? Okay. What is the admission procedures? All the details. Okay. That's the manual ledger will become my data. Okay. Or else when I'm uploading everything in the electronic format in a system, my computers will become the data infrastructure, which means that the structural arrangements where my data which is collected gets stored, okay, which is used for dissemination, we call them as a data infrastructure. Okay, that's the exact definition for the word data infrastructure, where you are storing your data, okay, through which you are analyzing your data, through which you are giving your data to other people. These structural arrangements, what you got in place to do this activity, is called as a data infrastructure. Okay, where the country is collecting. Okay, now we are going, we're trying to be more digital, but the thing is, question is about mention the ways to transform the data infrastructure in the economy. This is exactly the same words. Okay, transforming data infrastructure is given in economic survey. When you go to the economic survey, you can go look at the content. So now I look at the, we'll see the answer for the question. Okay, so first write the definition for the word data infrastructure. Then the thing is, explain the ways to transform the data infrastructure in India. What are the ways to transform data infrastructure means? For data infrastructure, there are the four processes. What are the four processes means? One is the how we are gathering the data. That's the first point number one. Second one, how we are storing the data. And third point is the how we are processing the data. Third one is the how we are disseminating the data. These are the four things. How we are disseminating, how we are processing, how we are storing. These are the four things. Your answer must be based on the four points. This is a data infrastructure, okay? Now, for example, this may appear as a simple points, but now let's see in this angle, okay? So it'll give a new dimension to you. So gathering data. Imagine that I'm a data collector. I'm taking some survey, okay? What is happening in India? I'm going to the field, okay? I'm asking to ma'am, okay? Ma'am, tell me what is the name, everything, okay? I'm collecting data in the paper. Then what I'm doing, okay? I'm coming to my office, and then what I'm doing, okay? I'm trying to do the data entry process. I'm converting them, okay? Or else what I'm doing, I'm just having data. I'm scanning the data and then uploading the document, okay? Which means that the data, when it gets scanned, when it's stored in the repository, it may appear as a digital data, okay? But scanned document, I cannot analyze, okay? Because I cannot aggregate the multiple scanned documents, okay? To aggregate the data, what I should do is data must not be scanned and uploaded. Data must be digitally entered in the thing, okay? For that, what should be done? Explain the ways, okay? What should be done is, instead of collecting the data and then doing data entry, what should be done is, while collecting the data itself, gathering can be done automatically electronic, okay? So while gathering itself, you do the data entry process. In that angle, all the data of the India will become more digital. That's the point number one. Okay, this is given as a detailed paragraph in economic survey. You get the gist alone. First one is there. So for example, from the paper to the digital, what we can do automatically, first stage itself digital. That's the point number one. Right, the one item. Question is about explain the ways to transform. So what is the ways? So instead of paper to digital, what we can do is the going directly digital. Going digital directly. That's the first one. So whatever data you're collecting, you do that automatically. That's the first infrastructure, okay? Going digital directly. And then this point and all, you have understanding purpose, okay? Because we know that scanning the documents, all the documents and having them is not a digital data, okay? It is a digital format you are storing, but it is also a manual data in the digital format, okay? But exactly when you are giving, then only using the programs, you can just analyze the data, okay? That we will see in this segment, in the processing, okay? Next one is the storing the data. What is the thing of the storing the data is, for example, imagine now I'm a person. I'm going to a school, okay? In the school, I'm asking the students, okay? How many days the teachers are coming to your school? How many toilets you have? Or are cleaning the toilets daily basis, okay? Like that, I'm collecting the data. But what I'm doing is the data I kept in the manual form, okay? But here, or else what I'm doing, okay, after 3 months. And after 6 months, what I'm doing, I'm trying to store the data in the electronic format by doing data entry. So what will happen? After 6 months only, the people, those who are the concerned officials, those who are staying at district level, they'll come to know in this village, in my district, they don't have the proper attendance of teachers, don't have the proper toilets, okay? They'll come to know after 6 months. After 6 months, when they go and take the action, okay, almost 6 months of valuable time of schooling would have got lost, okay? Which means that why this thing is taking place? Because the concerned officials are not able to have the data at the right time. Because why means data did not go to digital mode or did not get stored in digital format instantly, because the thing is that it is stored in the manual format for a long time. So what after, immediately after collecting, okay, you try to convert them into the electronic formats, or else during collecting itself, when you've done this, then this will become the most real-time data storing, okay? But what you are doing today, you are collecting, you are storing after 6 months, you are doing after 1 month, after 3 months, okay? So the word is the real-time storing of data. So when this is done, automatically this will happen, okay? But when this is not done, at least after 2 days, after 3 days, you collect the document, after 3 days, after a week itself, you upload, okay? So concerned district official, they'll come and inspect, they'll take action. So everything, okay? Imagine I'm going to a field. I'm asking the farmer, what is the problem in your field? Okay, they're saying, I'm not able to understand what weather complication is going to come on my field. Okay, so we understood what is the problem at the farmer level. Okay, this thing we are uploading after 2 months or 3 months. Okay, in the meantime, okay, there were example, the season would have crossed. After 3 months, the people are coming to know, okay, this people wants to have the information about a particular disaster or any weather changes at the right time. Okay, this is the thing what they want to convey. But we are storing data after 3 months means what would happen, okay? They finish the cultivation process. After the data, you try to convey the information, there is no use. So thing is the school example or the farmer example, the example is the try to feed the data or store them in the real time. That's again, okay? Is the way to transform the data infrastructure in India. Then comes the third thing, processing. Now done, I gathered data, I then after immediately on the spot I enter the data, or else after 2 days I upload the data in the digital format. Okay, but what is happening? Data is staying as a data. Okay, then what is the thing? Okay, there is no utility when data stays data. What should be done? Okay, the people, I am official. What I should do? I should take the documents. Oh, this is the thing. What is the problem? Okay, how many areas I have the problem? Okay, because you know that there is a very important statement in economics, because why the total world is going behind data means because, now imagine a common example, we all know. Okay, imagine a we have a particular number, okay? A student has got some 50 marks in examination, okay? If we ask you, how do you rate the marks? What do you say? 50 marks is average mark, okay? But what I am saying, next time I am saying, okay, this is not a 50, it's a 50 out of 50, okay? Then what do you say? Sir, this is excellent. So which means that this data gives some information, but data when compared to the denominator, it gives better information. Now next thing, what I am saying is not 50 out of 50, all the 10 students in the class got 50 out of 50, okay? Then what do you say? First you told average, then you told excellent, okay? Now you will say all the students 50 out of 50 means, we will say it's a average performance, which means that data, okay, when it's exactly assessed, okay, data becomes messengers of the economy, messengers of all the things happening. So for to do that, what we should do is we should analyze the data. But are we capable, all the officials, are they capable to assess the data? Means they don't have the technical qualification, they don't have the expertise, which means that we should train them so that they do the dissection of data, analyze the data at the right time, then only involved in the right action. In this angle, you can write the point, processing data, okay? The officials must be capable, okay? So in that angle to analyze the data, then only data will lead them, will show them some pathways that they can take action, okay? Then comes the last one. Processing data, you can write, okay? So analysis. Real-time analysis are as quick as possible, okay, so ASAP, okay, as soon as possible, analysis must be done, so which may help us to take the actions on time, that's the thing, okay. So, and imagine, okay, now a particular area, within a three months, the problem must be addressed, okay. But what is happening, the people are taking data, but uploading data after 6 months, then what is the use, the essence of collecting data would have lost, because within 3 months, action would have been taken, but the people are coming to know about the problem only after 6 months, because data is not properly uploaded. In this angle, the processing must be done, for that, the first two things must support, okay. Then comes the last one. What is the last one? Now we got many data, okay. Imagine that we have the Swachh Bharat mission, or we got the many programs. Now I'm asking you, okay, can you tell me about the performance of Swachh Bharat mission? What you'll do? We may go to some websites or the government data, we'll try to understand, okay. But what is the MGN Narega, okay? What is the exact, how many days they are given? What is the thing? We are not able to have the proper data because government is not transferring the data to the public, okay. So who is the exact beneficiary, okay? What works are carried out? We are not disseminating data to the proper people. What should be done? For that, there is a term called as a dashboards, okay. Dashboards are the information, okay, the information, the arrangements, okay. So what you can do in every office, every program, okay, village level, block level, state level, okay, we can create the dashboards where you have a particular program in your locality, okay. What is happening in the particular program, okay. So you collect the data, you upload them, and then you assess them, and then you give to the people itself, okay. So people, what they'll do, they'll social audit, they'll understand what is happening, okay. In this angle, all the things will take place in the right time, because when you are able to disseminate data, in India, what is taking place? Data is not getting disseminated, point number one. Even if it is getting disseminated, what is happening for some program? For Swachh Bharat mission, I think comparatively, government has given us to mention that we got some good dissemination. But the other programs, and all, we are not having the proper dissemination. And what is happening is even if we have data dashboards, these dashboards are not properly working in many areas. And other areas, people are not able to exactly understand, okay, what is the data say, okay. In this angle, these are the problems what we have. These are the ways what we can transform the data infrastructure. It's clearly given economic survey. Just to have some understanding about data infrastructure, okay. So this is the question number 13, okay. Now the question last one is the 14. Last one is very simple. We all know about the multidimensional poverty index, okay. Okay, now let's look at the question. Bring out the merits of multidimensional poverty measure over and above the monetary poverty, okay, which means that question is not asking you to write about the MDPA, okay, about the education, health, about the standard of living and all, you should not write, because question is not about the right about MDPA, right about the monetary poverty, okay. Question is about the bring about the merits of MDPA, okay. But anyway, it's a 15 mark question, so we can start with a decent intro. What is MDPA? What is the monetary poverty? MDPA, we all know, okay, it's a measurement, okay, measures the people whether deprived of the basic facilities or the basic access to the education and all, education, health and all, and standard of living. You give some intro about the MDPA, okay, who releases UNDP and the Oxford, okay. So and then you like that, you can give some intro, And below that, just I start the heading, merits of MDPI over the monetary poverty. Okay, first of all, MDPI we all know, monetary poverty also we know. Okay, monetary poverty also we give some small intro. So calculating poverty based on the monetary income. That's a normal poverty. Okay, so when you are earning $1.90 per day, okay, then you are not called as a poor. That's called as a monetary poverty. Here not concerned whether I go for schools and all. 1.90, whoever earning 1.90 will be called as APL, below 1.90 will be called as BPL. That is a monetary poverty. Monetary means based on monetary terms, not about access to education, not about quality of life. That's called as a monetary, that is a MDPA. Based on this, now we have to write about the merits of MDPA alone. Okay, we should not expand. So what is the merits? Point number one. So as we all know, MDPA is the multi-dimensional poverty index, which means that one dimension alone is not considered. Here it's only monetary dimension, but all the dimension is considered. So what, which gives us a complete idea. For example, one example given by the UNDP is, so based on the normal monetary poverty, when their data is compared to the MDPI, the total number of people living across the world, okay, is 50% higher in MDPI than the total count coming in the monetary poverty. Which means that when you measure in monetary poverty, people percentage is 50% lower, which means that we are able to understand the exact picture of poverty. Based on this, you can convert them as a point. How we can convert this? So this measurement is a comprehensive measurement of poverty, because not only one measure, many measures are considered. So this gives a complete idea of the poverty. That's the point number one. Okay, so the detailed thing will be sent in the key. Okay, first write the point. It's a comprehensive coverage of all areas. First one, merit is the, it covers all areas. Okay, all facilities, comprehensive coverage. Second point, what is second point is second point. For example, imagine that, okay, now in the monetary, non-monetary poverty, for example, in the multidimensional poverty, what we are doing is we are measuring the people's access to the education, health, and then basic infrastructure, what they got, everything we are considering, okay. These things and all, having the schools, having the hospitals, having the basic infrastructure, does not lie in the hands of the people, okay. But monetary poverty, the prosperity lies in the hands of the people. But for the people to come out of the multidimensional poverty, so the role of the government is also very crucial. So the how the government is taking care of the essentials can also be assessed, which means that how the, for example, the role of the public expenditure or role of the government can also be understood in the MDPA, which cannot be exactly understood in the monetary poverty, okay. So when you have proper schools, okay, which means yes, the government is also doing the role, okay. But monetary poverty measures only the income. But here, where you are, example, you can go to some other place, migrated, okay, there you can earn. But here, your locality should have the proper schools, should have the hospitals. So the impact of the public expenditures, government's role can also be understood by the MDPA, which cannot be understood by the monetary poverty. Point number two. Then comes the point number three. Point number two, we finish, gives idea about the public expenditure or the government's role on the poverty alleviation, okay. So that's the point number two. Then third point, for example, in the monetary poverty, okay, the people, those who are living in the monetary poverty, when the people are for example, imagine monetary poverty, one area people are 1.90, okay, the same value you are applying across the world, okay. When you compare the people, those who are earning above the monetary poverty in one country, when you compare this with the another country, okay, for example, now take for example, in the people, those who are coming above the monetary poverty, 1.90, people, those are coming above this line, okay, which means APL zone in the Latin America or Caribbean countries, okay, when they are compared with the sub-Saharan African countries, okay. So the people here also, in sub-Saharan area, APL people, sub-Saharan in the Latin American countries, APL people, okay. When these people are compared, these APL people are leading a better life than these countries, okay. So which means that, okay, within the monetary poverty APL category, we are not able to have the exact understanding. But the MDPA, okay, we are able to have the better understanding, which means that, so this gives the, and indicates the regional differences is exactly understood by the MDPA, which is not exactly understood by the normal monetary poverty. So write the point. Regional differences is exactly understood by the MDPA. Because what we say is in some area, even the 1.90 is a basic income. So in those countries, they'll get the money. But there are some countries, 1.90 is not the basic income, they'll not get the money. But here what happens in this concept, people, even though they earn above 1.90, they may not have the proper access, it's not getting reflected in the monetary poverty. But MDP exactly captures whether you got all the facilities, okay. It is not only about the money, it's a holistic coverage, so we're able to understand the regional differences. That's the point number three, okay. Then comes the next one, okay. Next one is the fourth point. What you can write is, next one is, Okay. For example, in our Asian country, okay, we got certain monetary poverty count, okay. But when you compare the Asian countries' monetary poverty count with the very, okay, for example, lower than the African countries. But when you compare the facilities what the Asian countries have with the sub-Saharan African countries, which means that the facilities are more in the Asian countries, but in the sub-Saharan African countries, we have the people don't have the basic facility, okay. Here, what we are trying to infer is, in the Asian countries, within the country, the urban people, they are not MDPA deprived. But the rural people, they are MDPA deprived, which means that the polarization of the society can also be understood by the MDPA, but the monetary poverty is not exactly pitching the polarization within the society. Okay, so double poles or tripoles maybe exist within society. This is not exactly pitched by the MDPA, but this is able to give the better picture because the exact count is measured. Okay, and then apart from that, okay, these are the things what you can write, okay, about the merits of the thing. Okay, first point, okay, 3 or 4 points, right? Then next question is, elucidate the status of poverty level of India according to the above two methods. This is the very factual things. Elucidate the poverty level of India. What is the poverty level, right? The data, factual things I'll give you. The global level is, first you understand the global level. 1.3 billion people are the MDPA poor. 1.3 billion people are MDPA poor. That's the data given by UNDP. 1.3 billion. And apart from that, what is the total count is in India? In the 2005-06, the total MDPA poor, 2005-06, it was around 640 million. 640 million, 2005-06. But in the MDPA index released for the year 2015-16, in India, the total count was 369 million. This was India's poverty population based on data. 369 million from 3640, India got reduced. Okay, this is the data for the year 15-16, released on last year, October 2018. Okay, then this percentage is around 27.9%. 27.9% is the poverty data of India. This percentage, because, but in 2005, India's percentage was 55.1% based on MDPA, not based on the monetary poverty, based on the MDPA, it was around 55.1%. It is around 27.9%. So 369 million is our level, but when you compare with the Nigeria is the next in line. Okay, the level is the almost data is the 96 million what they have. Then the Pakistan, other countries, they are coming some data. Okay, you not go that much data. You write the India's level 1.3, India's level 369 million, and then some 270 million people went out of poverty in the 10 years. That's a very phenomenal achievement of India. So that's the India's achievement. Next one is the monetary poverty. Monetary poverty, India does not have any valid data. The last data was the data by whom? Okay, which committee is given? Suresh Tendulkar committee data was the last data. Based on that, you can write 27 rupees, write the head as a Suresh Tendulkar committee. Two methods, monetary poverty. Suresh Tendulkar, because you know that Rangarajan committee and Suresh Tendulkar, government accepted the Suresh Tendulkar. So based on that, so India's poverty was 21.9%. 21.9. What is the poverty line? 21.9. What is the poverty line based on the 21.9? Is the India's 1000 rupees per day per month, and then 816 rupees per month. That's the data. Okay, that's poverty line is not required. Just write the status of poverty level in India according to the above two methods. Okay, this is the answer. First, you frame the first segment of the question. The next one, you write the points for second one. Okay, this is the answer for the question. Okay, detailed answer key. The same thing what I told. Same thing. I'll convert them to statements. I'll send the answer key. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Next will be internal security. Arvind sir, also.
How was the paper?
Internal security questions.
Right. So we had three questions, right? Three questions in internal security. Question number 8 is about AFSPA. Question number 9 is about cyber security. Question number 19 is about space defense. All right. So fifth one. And that's more on science and technology. All right. So these are the three questions we had. So all three questions were of different dimensions. With respect to space, the question I asked, it's about your own interpretation, innovation, strategies. All right. So the question is expected, the answer. All right. So the answer is expected from you, kind of innovation from you, whatever it is, the kind of strategy. So this is a kind of more open-ended question. All right. With respect to cybersecurity, again, you have to know about the government schemes. All right. So unless you know the schemes, you cannot answer this question. It's a very straightforward question. All right. And with respect to AFSPA, this needs a lot of discussion. All right. So this one, you need to, this question center around the Supreme Court judgment. All right. So these are the questions, you have to know what kind of questions is asked. All right. So this is more open-ended. So this is more open-ended. This is more, you have to find out the, you have to tell about the government schemes, and this is where you need a lot of discussion. All right. So we'll discuss one by one what exactly. All right. So I'll give you the kind of detailed possible notes also, but in the meantime, I'll make it short. All right, what are you supposed to write in this one? How you have to introduce and how you have to include the body part and how you have to conclude it. All right. So the first question, the Armed Forces Special Powers Act of 1958 does not provide the armed forces an absolute immunity from trial or criminal proceedings by the courts. Discuss. All right. So here the question is about AFSPA. All right. So this is basically a statement taken from the 2016 Supreme Court judgment. All right. So the case name is Extrajudicial Execution Victim Family Association case. Extrajudicial Execution Victim Families Association versus the Union of India. All right. So this is an observation made by the Supreme Court that AFSPA doesn't have any absolute immunity. All right. So the answer should center around this one. But before that, you can't straight away write this one. So before that, how you got to introduce? So since it's about AFSPA, all right. So you have to mention something, some recent things. Maybe you can mention about how many states, the recent extension for Nagaland, or how it has brought down in Arunachal Pradesh. Maybe something like that. All right. So mention about those things. Maybe two lines, not more than 2 to 3 lines. All right. So thereafter, start saying that why it is contentious. Because so it's speaking about absolute immunity, right? So next, you speak about some of the provisions related to AFSPA. So what are the contentious provisions related to AFSPA? AFSPA has only 6 sections, right? All right. So the contentious provisions are section 4, 5, 6. Section 4 powers, 4 gives the armed forces the special powers. So section 4 of AFSPA speaks about special powers given to the armed forces. Like for instance, if the armed forces suspect any person who is acting in contravention of any law, they can seize the property, they can enter his house, they can even cause the death of the person also, provided if he has any arms or something like that. All right. So that is the special powers with respect to AFSPA. Section 5 speaks about the person who is suspected to be that, the terrorist or insurgent, or all those people who is acting in contravention of the law, that person should be produced before the police. All right. So the arrested person should be produced before the police immediately. So this is what's said about section 5. Section 6 speaks about the immunity given. It speaks about the immunity given. What is the immunity given to these armed forces? That is, no suit or no criminal proceeding. No criminal proceeding or prosecution. These three things cannot happen without the previous sanction of central government. That is the most contentious part. All right. So without this understanding, you cannot answer this question. Got it? So it is not about the special powers you have. It is about the immunity which is given. Everyone has self-defense. Even you, me, normally everyone has self-defense. But this self-defense, what happened for you and me? I know the case is filed, we have to defend ourselves, it is done with a self-defense. I have killed that person with a self-defense. But these armed forces, they cannot be filed a case. They cannot be prosecuted. They cannot be initiated a legal proceeding without the previous sanction of the central government. That is the contentious one. All right. So you have to mention about these things. And So these powers are misused. So rarely they used to produce them. So in some cases, they used to produce the persons after 5 years. All right. So they take the kind of powers of the police also. So by mentioning those things, then you have to go ahead like, okay, so the contentious provision is section 6. Now, what is the contention here? Armed forces say section 6 gives absolute immunity. They interpret section 6 of AFSPA that gives absolute immunity to them. But on the other hand, the code says there is no absolute immunity. So this is where you have to focus on. So what court has said? So maybe you can mention about what Supreme Court has said in the year 1998. In 1998, for the first time, AFSPA's constitutional validity was discussed, which said AFSPA is constitutionally valid. All right. So they said like that is a case of Naga People's Movement. I'll give you the case law and all. Don't worry about that. So in which the court said AFSPA is constitutionally valid, but ensure that you follow certain do's and don'ts. And if you don't give prosecution, if you don't give sanction for prosecution, the government has to record the reasons. If the government fails to give reasons. So according to section 6 of AFSPA, no armed forces can be prosecuted without the sanction of government. So if the central government takes a delay or if it doesn't give any sanctions, they have to give the reasons. That is what been said. So maybe you can incorporate that element also if you want to. And then you have to focus on the 2016 case. You know what they said in 2016 case? 2016 case, the Supreme Court was looking after the extrajudicial killings in the state of Manipur. Extrajudicial execution victim family association of Manipur. All right. So what they said, the Supreme Court said in this case, if at all armed forces is involved in any of the encounters, they are not immune. They are not immune. In that case, they can be prosecuted normally by the criminal courts. Meaning what? They need not wait for the martial courts. All right. Normally, except for murder, rape and other things, any offenses related to army people, that will be handled by martial courts. Court martials they use. All right. But if the armed forces have done any murder, rape, if it is a fake encounter, they can be prosecuted under a normal criminal code. That is what they said. Got it? Understood it? Fine. So this is how you have to say. Fine. So the court said that if at all the armed forces have involved in these things, they are not under the court martials, they will be facing the normal criminal courts. That is a key point. But unfortunately, what happened, even now, there is a kind of ambiguity in that. Like, so the court is not clear about like whether AFSPA should be there, whether that section 6 should be scrapped, or whether they can face the kind of trials and all. So court is not clear about it. Like the court leaves the ball in the court of the government. So when the government wanted a debate, court said that no, whatever it is, you decide it. We are not going to decide and debate. And that is how you have to end it. So the discussion, you have to end it that. So there is a kind of cloud of ambiguity in the AFSPA's judgment also. Why I have taken this question? Because recently in the year 2018, what happened? In the year 2018, in the 2018 December, some 300 people, armed forces, commissioned as well as non-commissioned officers, they went to the court to quash the FIR filed by CBI. But court said, you go and face the music. I can't give that. Like, if you're really innocent, go and prove yourself. Purida, that is the reason why I've taken this question also. So please find out the 2018, what the Supreme Court observed on that, and the 2016 judgment on this one, and 1998 judgment also. All right, so you have to start with the introduction and your focus has to be on the sections 6 and then you have to end with this part. Got it? Any doubts on this one? Any doubts? Fine. Next question. In the last few decades, military campaigns have demonstrated the significance of space technology for military purposes. In this context, suggest a suitable approach to the idea of formulating a space security policy and a space doctrine for India. All right. So here it is. The first statement you have to say how far space is used for military campaigns. Can you give me some examples? ASAD, okay, that is our thing, right? So apart from ASAD from India, Mission Shakti, what were the recent other things? Reconnaissance. Missile defense systems, how it is used, okay. Good. So USA also, they are also planning for a space agency, like space command actually, the space force. All right. So maybe the recent examples, for instance, in 2019 February, USA said like we are going to have a sixth force called Space Force. They're going to have a space command. All right. Similarly, France also announced a kind of a space command also. Fine. So these are the examples you have to mention and how space is used, like ASAD. China has made it in 2007. So how our neighboring countries does it? All right. So how space is used, not just for communication, not just for remote sensing, beyond that, like how it is used as a military thing, you have to mention about it. Like I've given a lot of options in the answer sheets, in the notes, a lot of options. You don't write the entire thing. Maybe out of which you can incorporate some of the elements. I'll give a detail, almost 2-3 paragraphs. Any of those points you can include. All right. The major point is that, so the connecting bridges, so once you have said like how military campaign is used in the space, in the fourth domain, then you have to mention the need. What is the need? Because other countries, they have made it. Now it is our thing, like we have to have a policy. Already we don't have, like this is, you can connect it with the kind of like recently, there is a discussion going about no first use policy doctrine also, right? Maybe. All right. So clubbing the no first use policy as well as the ASAD, I've taken this question. Got it? So now you can say like, okay, what is the need to have a space policy as well as a doctrine? So I've asked like, suggest a suitable approach. So I've just asked the approach. What are the components of this policy? What are the components of this doctrine should be? Eppadi irukkum, tell me. How the components of this one should be? Okay, deterrence. So first, like we'll speak about the policy. Then we'll speak about the doctrine. So normally policy means what? So what is the policy? So recently, national education policy, most of it have gone through that. In the case of national education policy, so what are the components of that? Guidelines. What sort of guidelines? How should we have a law? What sort of institutions we should have it? Is it not? What sort of reforms we should go for it? Is it not? So policy just gives a kind of broader picture about all those things. Institutions, legislations, whatever kind of regional, national cooperation, everything, right? So that is what, like your policy, it can be, it should have these mechanisms, like institutional mechanisms. So how you're kind of planning to have an institutions in this one? What about the legislations or legal mechanisms? What are the proposed legal legislations? Because we don't have a space related act, right, in India. So how to have it? How to react with the international treaties? All right. Apart from that, like since we are speaking specifically about space defense, you have to mention about the kind of structural thing and the operational ones. For instance, when I speak about institutional mechanisms, like we are planning to have a kind of defense, cyber, as well as defense space agency, right? So defense space agency, you can write it in structural more than that. What are the structural reforms? What is the structure? Structural reforms means what? All right, within that body, so we are planning to have a defense space agency, a tri-command defense space agency also. Maybe examples like this. For instance, the case of legal mechanism, you have to mention about the need for a new comprehensive legislation for space. All right, and in the case of institutional mechanisms, like recently, whatever with respect to space, it is governed by ISRO, right? It's mostly governed by ISRO. We don't have a dedicated one for space security. Maybe you should have a kind of, you can name some agency, for instance, something like this, National Authority for Space Security. National Authority for Space Security. So something like that. Okay, so you can propose. So this is the structure. This is what majorly important. And definitely you can speak about the cooperation also. The need for bilateral cooperation, regional cooperation also. All right. So without having the cooperation, international regional cooperation, you can't succeed because space belongs to everyone. Is it not? Fine. So this is what the structure, the skeleton has to be. All right. So while you are writing this thing, especially in the case of policies, you know, you can, you should incorporate these words. For instance, like to create, to develop, to upgrade, to enhance, to promote, to collaborate, to cooperate, to build. Is it not? So try to use a different words for this. These kind of words that will help you in answer writing. Build such vocabularies. All right. To upgrade, and anything else you want to say? To create, to develop, to enhance, to facilitate. All right. So these are the words, try to use it. I'll include those components also in case of policies. Whenever they're asking about the policies, so please try to say, to create this one, to enhance, to upgrade, to collaborate, to cooperate. All right, there is a lot of words you can use it, like, so use this in policy. All right, so now the coming to the other part, like the technical part is space doctrine. What about the space doctrine? What about the space doctrine? So while maintaining a doctrine, like, you know, do we have a nuclear doctrine? No first use policy, but no, it's not like, it's not pretty well documented. So even the military document, it is kind of very confidential in nature. All right. So nuclear is also like, no, we are saying that we don't have a first use policy. All right. So that is with respect to anything, not just military, even for nuclear, for any other things also, with respect to the security measures. We never go aggressively and we don't go offensively attack anybody, right? So that component has to be included. Where in a panel, space doctrine, where in a mind, okay, first use panlam. Okay, maybe whatever it is, you have to see. It's not about like whether you have to include, like, but you have to justify that. The approach why we should go for first use policy, you should justify that. That is what matters. You say no first use policy, I can say India is always having this one. That is the reason why, despite being we are not members of other regimes like NSG, we are getting the nuclear material supplies or not. So same way I can go ahead. But if you're saying that like you should go for first use policy, you have to give a justification. Okay, fine. Oh, that's what, like, you have to give such examples. Good. Fine. Next is other things you can mention about the doctrine is, for instance, like whenever we have a specific doctrine, you have to keep in mind about the compliance with the space law. All right. So we should not make any doctrines which is kind of like, no, see, till today, no country speaks about any specific doctrine, outer space doctrine, how it should be used for military purposes. They are using for civilian as well as military purposes, but no country has explicitly mentioned that space, we are using space for military. All right. So similarly, we should also respect the outer space treaty. So in a such a way that we should not contravene with the provisions of outer space, we have to formulate the doctrine, number two. And we have to think about, like, when you are speaking about space doctrine, we have to speak about the space debris also, right? It should not result in debris also. We should have that thing in mind. Fine. And you can speak about international cooperation also, this component. So having these components, I have given all the list. All right. So having these things in mind. All right. So the compliance with space law, addressing the inadequacies in the national law, no first use policy for military purposes, mitigation of space debris, all these points I've given. All right. So these points you should keep in mind while formulating or a framework doctrine. Got it? Any doubts in this one? Any doubts in this one? This is a kind of open-ended. See, you need not stop with that. You can include more points also, but these are the points definitely you have to include. I've given as a general studies only. I don't go technical. I never gone technical. I said, like, that is the reason why. Look here. See, these points I've given, this will fit into any of the policies. These two specifically, I spoke about structural and operational because of defense. Got it? Fine. Okay. Next, last question. With the proliferation of information technology and related services, cyber attacks have become a global phenomenon. With India's epicenter, briefly outline the initiatives of Government of India. All right. So the first one, you have to mention about the statement, right? So what is the statement? Like, proliferation of information technology and related services, cyber attacks have become a global phenomenon with India at its epicenter. You have to mention how far India is affected. So go for statistics. All right. So UPSC, like, you know, if you give a valid, reliable statistics, you have the kind of possibility of getting more marks. All right. So have some statistics with respect to cybersecurity always. So here I have some of this security. For instance, CERTIN. You know what is CERTIN, right? What is CERTIN? Computer Emergency Response Team, India. So CERTIN has said, like, they have given the data. For instance, in the year 2016, it was 199. It was 2017, it is 172. These sort of data I've given. All right. So just listen. Like, I'll give you the note. Don't worry about that. All right, so they give in the data, try to give data by CERTIN, because CERTIN is India's most, you can say, the kind of nodal agency related to cybersecurity, right? So whatever the information given by CERTIN, anything, it carries more validity than any agency. All right, so give some examples like that. Data's like, for instance, CERTIN has given a report in 2018, most of the attacks come from China. Most of our, if you take 100 attacks on Indian government websites, 35 of those attacks comes from China. All right, so we got to be concerned. So mention about those things, and then, like, you can go ahead with the initiatives straight away. The major focus on the initiatives. So what sort of initiatives government has? Please tell me now. What sort of solutions? Preventive and cybersecurity. Okay, we have a cybersecurity policy. Good. Okay, policy level one thing. Good. Good. Next one. So definitely you have to first of all speak about policy. We have a policy which is in 2013. Good. Next. What about laws? Next, legislations. Okay, what sort of legislations we have? What are the legislative mechanisms? IT Act. Good. IT Act as amended on 2008. Good. Okay, illa. First heading solunga, structure padra, answer solradhukku munadi. Policy, legislation, appuram awareness solla. Institutional mechanisms. What sort of institutions? Good. NCIIPC, what is it? National Critical Infrastructure Protection Center, right? So now, so since you have lot of institutions, maybe if you can, MHA killa, what are the institutions under MHA? What are the institutions under PMO? What are the institutions under Ministry of Defense? For instance, Ministry of Defense, we have a proposed Defense Cyber Agency. And in the case of PMO, this is the one. In case of MHA, you have a cyber police. All right. So those things I have given. For instance, institution mechanism. Under the case of MHA, you have a cyber warrior police force, National Cyber Coordination Center, NCCC. All right. And PMO, you have NCIIPC. Ministry of Defense, you have a Defense Cyber Agency or a Tri-Service Cyber Command. And you have to mention about MeITY. What is MeITY? Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. So under MeITY only, you have CERTIN. All right. And Cyber Swachhta Kendra, Botnet Cleaning and Malware Analysis Center. Like, all right. So all these things are given. So please go through that. And what about other, apart from institutional mechanisms, there are a lot of schemes also available. Schemes like Cyber Surakshit Bharat Initiative. Cyber Surakshit Bharat Initiative of MeITY. Surakshit Bharat Initiative. This is of MeITY. MeITY. And under MHA, you have a cybercrime reporting portal. You have Indian Cybercrime Coordination Center. All right. These sort of schemes also, you can mention it. And you can speak about the recent international mechanisms also, like how we have kind of gone for Budapest Convention, anything recently. Paris Call for Action, good. Christchurch Call also can include as a part of internal. Social media, cyber security, good. So these elements you can include it. How India being part of these actions. Got it? Fine. This is how you have to at least try to give these. See, whatever I have provided is the minimal thing. All right. So as far as the interaction, whatever I given the note, include any of those interactions. You need not incorporate every element. All right. Fine. Anything else? Any doubts? Any doubts? Fine. Thank you so much. All the very best to you.
Good. So one announcement regarding your mock test. Next week you have this mock test GS1234, right? The venue will be decided. It will be a simulation mock test. So the venue will be on a school. The venue, it will be updated, but as of now, it will be not conducted here. It will be in a school, okay? Inform as soon as possible. Inform. Don't come here. It will be updated, but again. So coming to question number 6. I think you know what is the difference between organic farming and sustainable farming, right? What is the difference between organic farming and sustainable farming? So organic farming is complete usage of organic. So when you use the organic word organic, don't use organic chemicals. No, it is organic manures. Okay? Or organic fertilizers, don't use like that. It is organic manures. Okay. Inorganic may be chemical or inorganic can be a fertilizers. Okay. Sustainable farming is a judicious mix of both. That is a simple difference. Coming to principles of sustainable farming and organic farming. For organic farming, there are 4 principles: fairness, ecology. See, everything is like key. Don't worry, don't have to write. Health. So what is fairness is? The organic farming should be such a way that it is fair enough for the entire stakeholders. Not only for the farmers, even for the person who are integrated in the entire supply chain. Not only for the supply chain, fairness for the resources, effective usage of resources. That is what is fairness. Ecology, as you know, it is nothing but causing no harm to the ecology. Then care. Care, what it talks now? Talks about sustaining the generation of now as well as sustaining the generation of future. And health, it talks about overall health. Health of the ecosystem, health of the people. That is very important. Coming to sustainable farming. See, organic farming or organic agriculture are one and the same. Sustainable farming or sustainable agriculture, one and the same. Coming to principles of sustainable farming. First is, sustainable farming focuses on efficiency. Resource efficiency is the first principle. Second is resilience. Because the beauty of the sustainable agriculture is it is resilient farming. So only we are promoting more sustainable agriculture because we are facing a problem of climate change, right? So whenever we talk about climate change, you can talk about this as a remedy, right? Second is resilience. And third is direct action. This is very important. Sustainable farming talks about direct action. That is bottom-up approach. And fourth is, the sustainable farming must ensure a balance between economic, ecosystem, and society. Now coming to the next question, 7th question, any doubts? Coming to the second question, problem soils. What is a problem soil? So, when a soil loses its fertility, when the soil loses its fertility, we call it as problem soils. What are the problem soils, you know? So, 3 of soils, very important. So far, this soil-based question has not cropped up. So small margin of error is possible here. Please ensure you don't make that mistake. Suppose these are the major classification. There are many other problem soils. So we have to focus only on these 3 because this is prevalent in pan India level. Okay. Coming to acid soil, what is the first? What is the pH of this? Less than 7. Saline. What is this? This is very important. If anything is asked on problem soils, this classification is very important. This is electrical conductivity. Electrical conductivity. So this just a discuss question. What are the reasons? Tell me one or two reasons why problem soils happens. It may be of two types, anthropogenic or natural. Natural is how? Rainfall. First is rainfall, very important. Wherever there are heavy rainfall, acid soil is the outcome because of heavy leaching. And second is parent material. Then anthropogenic, no, everything. You can write anything. Poor use of fertilizers, improper agriculture practices, conversion of farmland into so whatever you feel like. What is the reclamation? Very important. What is the reclamation for acid soil? So it is acid, we have to add salt, right? What type of salts? Lime. Then proper drainage practices. Drainage. Slag. The rock, right? Cement industries. Sorry, my handwriting is very poor. பிரசிடென்சி ஜெய்கோபால் கருடைய தேர்ட் சென்டர் என்னது மீன்ஸ் எழுதுறீங்களா எல்லாரும் அவர் அப்ரிங் ஃபார் மீன்ஸ் ரெண்டு தானா ஸோ பை மெயின்டைனிங் ப்ராப்பர் ட்ரைனேஜ் வி கேன் எலிமினேட் சாரி ஒரே டெவலப்மெண்ட் ஸோ ப்ளீஸ் திஸ் இஸ் நாட் ஃபார் திஸ் இஸ் ஃபார் சாரி drainage kidaya coming to saline soils see it is full of salt right bases we have to make it more neutral so we can add acids what is the source of acids for this this is nothing but organic manures farmyard manure the other all organic sources you can write because organic manures when it decomposes gets converted as humic acid so that acid utilizes the salt. Again, the common for both is drainage. For this drainage and proper irrigation practices, very important. Because the problem of saline soils is more prevalent in wherever we have this problem of poor or faulty irrigation practices. Excess irrigation, proper not following proper drainage. Where if you go for a map, where can you locate these places? Punjab, Haryana. So these places where we have this canal irrigation, very for this same for this alkali, except you can go for iron pyrites and gypsum. See, don't write gypsum here, very wrong. Only for alkali soil, gypsum and iron pyrite. Coming to 17th question, I think it's a very easy question. So you know, just a discuss question. See what all points we can see. Just is discuss and this open-ended question. I know everyone would have written. Just tell me four or five points. We can go to next question. See horticulture. What? Fruits, vegetables, then? Huh? Ornamental flowers, okay. So many people may miss this, so I asked. Spices and condiments. I don't know how many of you missed this. spices and condiments, flowers, floriculture, gardening and landscaping, plantation crops, medicinal and aromatic crops. So this question was purposely put just to make you aware of what are the components of the horticulture. Very important. I know many would have written fruits, vegetables, maybe flowers, but definitely would have missed this plantation crops, medicinal crops, spices, condiments, gardening and landscaping also is a part of horticulture. So when you talk about horticulture as such, you can look at a map and show wherever the possibility of fruits, vegetables. For example, Nilgiris or Northeast India, we can talk about tea, coffee, plantation crops, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, etc., these vegetables. So you can talk about those things. So what is the advantage of horticulture? Because only in horticulture crops, the scope of value addition is more. Food processing industry can thrive only because of horticulture. So that is the main issue. If you have to touch horticulture and the income, definitely food processing is the main point they would be expecting. Value addition, food processing. Because only 2% to 3% of our perishable products are getting a value added. When compared to Western countries, where 40 to 50% are getting value added. At the same time, post-harvest losses in India is around 30 to 40% of the perishables are lost during post-harvest. So this is the problem with India. But at the same time, all developed countries have reduced the post-harvest losses as well as they have more value addition. So this is the point you should connect in this question. Anything you want to add? Definitely you should have gone for a diagram for this. Even for the problem soils, you should have gone for a diagram. I don't know how many you drew. Era Varanjingla. Anyone draw a map of India? Good. Again, when you draw a map also, use the map very effectively. Just to, for location of one or two spaces, don't use map. If you just draw a map, problem soils now, just locate, what are the reasons? For example, if you are talking about Punjab, Haryana, due to canal irrigation. If you are talking about southern regions, because of fault irrigation practices. If you are talking about some West Bengal, etc., because of riverine problems. So make more value addition to your diagrams also. Just a diagram, just to overall put one or two points, don't draw, okay? Make most out of each diagrams, okay? Coming to the other question, 18, definitely sure shot we can say 18 trillion, $5 trillion question may be a essay also. We can expect an essay, or at least in paper 2, paper 3, we can expect a question definitely on $5 trillion economy. So connect all the aspects of our GS 1, 2, 3, 4 including essay to this $5 trillion economy, most awaited questions. When smart cities were on the news, they asked three questions from smart cities, paper 2, 3 and 4, I think so. So very important. So brush something on 5 trillion economy. So how can you say this, how to connect agriculture with 5 trillion economy? Okay. See, one point is, I don't know how many of you touched this. Occupation which is pan India is agriculture. So when agriculture is touched, agriculture is the only profession which can reduce the income inequality. So this point must be there because this is critical discussion. So for manufacturing, it requires skills. So if you touch manufacturing, income inequality, it is not possible. But when you touch agriculture, it is 50% of farmers or people are dependent on that. So we can reduce the income inequality, poverty, etc. only by touching agriculture. What is the size of agriculture in our GDP? 17%. What is the size of Indian GDP? 2.6 trillion. How much agriculture contributes to GDP? 16% or 17% of 2.6 trillion, around maybe 360, 370 billion dollars. This data must be there. Because for increasing farmers' income, we talked about what? The income of farmers must be known, right? We concluded like around 25 to 30,000 is the nominal income of the farmers. If that is the case, even for such questions, trillion dollar, you should know what is the contribution of each sector when it comes to GDP. then only you can talk about at least 1 trillion must come from agriculture. So we are only 400 billion now. See, you can argue, right? This is critically discussed only, no? We are just 400 to 350 to 400 billion agriculture. At least 1 trillion is expected, $1 trillion is expected. These are the contribution which can make or lift our economy to a $5 trillion economy. So just even for this, you can use a map, right? The scope for map is there in every question. Just you have to just analyze and write. So what are the components you can talk here? I don't know how many of it touched. You should touch agriculture here, horticulture, food processing, allied industries like fisheries, dairy, agroforestry. I don't know how many of you touched all these. You want to touch all these? Good. So if all touch panna mattum dhaan, this answer is complete. You should touch at least all the allied activities, including agriculture. Okay. Any doubts? Something about the mains. How many of you are writing for the first time? Okay. See, suppose, I don't know how many of you will encounter this, but suppose if you encounter, if you are starting right, if you have started to write, maybe an option will face this. Because option, you should write 5 answers, right? Suppose you started 2A, and after writing 4 lines, you want to cancel this question, and you have to write only 3rd question. Here it will be A, B, C, D, right? Suppose if you want to cancel, what is the way to cancel this? How to cancel this? See, you should strike it like this and write cancelled. This is the proper way of cancelling. Just by striking out, it is not finished. You should write it is cancelled. I don't know how many of you know this. Anyone know this? Very important. All the blank sheets must be scored out. Okay, only with pen. And do not use red pen. How many of you have the habit of using red pen? I know many people used to draw, etc., with a lot of colors. Why red color? Because the examiner will be using only red to evaluate. So don't contradict with your examiner, right? And again, one more important. If this is the question, you will be given the space to write here, right? Do not write anything on this question. How many of you have the habit of structuring here? Underline, don't do anything. Whatever you want to do it in the question paper you have. It is allowed or not in UPSC? We do not know, actually. Inge ezhudhuradhu, it is not allowed, even UPSC said it explicitly. But inge ezhudhuradhu pathi UPSC has not given any instructions, but there's a possibility that UPSC eppo eppadi nadakkumnu solla mudiyadhu. Because suppose there's a question number 10 right here, inge or a what ingra question irukku vechukku, in the water ella question if you are circling, what will happen? Just this is indicated to the examiner that this particular paper belongs to me, right? Malpractices is possible everywhere. That is why UPSC says do not write anything else other than the answer script. Point purichada? Did you get my point? So avoid, underline, okay, no problem, but don't do lot of scribbling works here. Okay, whatever you want to do it in the loose sheets here. Okay, in the margin la definitely la pokudadu, in the margin la maybe 1 or 2 roman letters or star, whatever you feel like you can put. Okay, and again, very important, I don't know how many of you practice this, 15 10, this is the pattern of questions we are following. Anything may come. 12.5 varalam, 10 varalam, illa 20 questions, 20 mark question can also come. We don't know. Every 2 to 3 years UPSC changes the pattern, so be prepared for the change also. Don't go with the mindset that it will be 10 marks only, it is a 50 marks only. Just change the, if when you saw a question paper based on the marks, just adjust accordingly. Okay, that's it. All the best. You will have science and tech.
What's the science question? நானும் எப்பயுமே கேட்குற கேள்வி எப்பயுமே உங்கள்கிட்ட வர ரெஸ்பான்ஸ் ஸ்மைலி. ஓகே, ஸோ ஃபர்ஸ்ட் அந்த என்ன கொஸ்டின், அந்த நிதி ஆயோக் வித் ரெஸ்பெக்ட் டு த இ வெஹிக்கிள்ஸ், அந்த கொஸ்டின் தான் கொடுத்துறேன். எப்படி கொடுத்துறான்னு தெரியல. நிதி ஆயோக் வித் ரெஸ்பெக்ட் டு த இ வெஹிக்கிள்ஸ்ல வாட் இஸ் அ கொஸ்டின் விச் இஸ் கிவன் இன் சென்ஸ், கிரிட்டிக்கலி எவால்வேட், கிரிட்டிக்கலி எவால்வேட் த நீட் டு ஹாவ் த பிரசன்ஸ் ஆஃப் எலக்ட்ரிக்கல் வெஹிக்கிள்ஸ் இன் இந்தியா. So first, when it comes for a critical evaluation, we need to speak with respect to context what is given over there. So Niti Aayog is planning something. What is planning in sense? Anyhow, by the year of 2030, they aim to have a 100% replacement. That's the word. Niti Aayog aims to have a 100% replacement of existing petroleum and diesel vehicles with the help of electrical vehicles. So we need to have a cross check whether this 100% replacement is possible or not. That's the reason we went for a critical evaluation. And once you are started to move towards a electrical vehicles in sense, on the other hand, we can able to have a reduction with respect to oil import. So like that, you can able to speak something about the recent recommendations given by the Niti Aayog initially. And after that, for speaking about some 2 to 3 lines, directly you can jump for the critical evaluation part. Critical evaluation. So what is the need? The first thing is that in order to combat the environmental problems as well as to meet the target given by INDC, so what is the thing given over here in sense? Transportation is one among the major important sector in India which consumes more amount of oil resources. Now in that case, it has been estimated that once the whole country is going to have the presence of electrical vehicles by 2030, now what you can able to minimize in sense, 67%, the report is saying that 67% of fuels can be saved. Along with that, 37% of carbon dioxide emissions can be minimized. So this is the promise what we have under the INDC. So in order to meet the promise what we have under the INDC, along with respect to the minimization of the fuel, we need to go for the electrical vehicles. That's a need. Positive. What is the negative in sense? The negative arises in the form of batteries. Because electrical vehicles, surely they depend upon the batteries for their operation. When come for a battery, plenty of choices is being available. So lithium ion battery, lead acid batteries, cadmium batteries, plenty of batteries available, which is comfortable, they can able to prefer for it, but lithium ion is the most preferable one. But you have other options also. So now there comes a challenging task with the batteries. What is the challenging task with the batteries in sense? With respect to the batteries, recyclable, huge question mark arises in the form of recycling. Huge question mark arises in the form of recycling. Without having the recycling, simply if you are promoting with the electrical vehicles in sense, it creates environmental problem, e-wastage. So now, since wide range of batteries is available, all the batteries is not 100% recyclable natural. Lithium ion battery is 100% recyclable. Except lithium ion battery, the other batteries, lead acid and other things, can't be have 100% recyclable. So in that case, the question mark arises in the form of recyclable negative. What is the evaluation is being done? The evaluation where the recycling, and here you need to speak with respect to the steps what the government had taken in the aspect of missions or programs or the schemes. So what is the step government had taken in sense under the mission innovation? Government is planning to establish recyclable centers in the major cities. First they are going to establish some recycling centers. So once you are facing with respect to the non-usage of the battery, you can able to hand it over there. So in that case, government itself taking a step to go for recycling. Already we have plenty of recyclable centers to be there. But what is the problem with the recycling centers in sense? The recycling centers is ready to go for recycling for the lead acid batteries and the other batteries. But where comes the problem in sense? They are not ready to go for lithium ion batteries. The reason is that the amount what they need to spend to recycle the lithium ion batteries will be 5 times more costlier when compared to the purchasing of lithium in the form of a raw material itself. The raw material of lithium is cheaper rather than comparing with respect to recycled lithium. And that's the reason the recycle centers is not ready to go for a recycling of lithium. Even though lithium ion battery is 100% recyclable, the amount what they need to venture for recycling is extreme. So they can't able to go for the recycling with lithium. They are preferring to utilize the raw material of lithium itself. So now, instead of depending on the private players, if government itself taking a step to establish some recycled centers, that could be the solution. Positive, negative, along with the evaluation. Here we are spoken in the aspect of environment. Second, what you can say in sense, with respect to the Make in India program. Make in India program. So here, as a part of Make in India program, what you can able to say in sense, we are opening the doors for the new kind of automobile sectors. New type of automobile sectors. Positive. Where comes a negative in sense? Already the existing automobile companies is being in the stressful condition. So what is the stressful condition in sense? One hand, they need to switch over to the Bharat Stage 6 by 2020. That's the first stress. They need to convert into the Bharat Stage 6 by 2020. Already the government had given the target. Now all the fund what they have in the hand had been invested to have a proper manufacturing of the Stage 6 vehicle. They had invested a lot. Now, on the other hand, Niti Aayog is suggesting that the whole country need to have the presence of electrical vehicles by 2030 and since all the companies will be in a condition not to lose their scope in the market. Anyhow, they want to retain their name in the market. So now they need to invest something in the R&D to manufacture the electrical vehicles. When it comes for investment, they don't have the fund. Now, where they'll be depending? They'll be depending upon the bank loans. Whether the bank loans will be ready to provide them, because already we have huge hike with respect to NPA issues. So even though the government is giving an opportunity to open the new kind of a sector in the automobile sector, they need to have setting kind of a capital amount to invest their R&D. Because the government is stressing them in two aspects, one in the aspect of Bharat Stage 6, on the other hand, they need to go for the electrical vehicles. Too much amount of stress will be there in the case of the financial sector for the automobile companies. What can be the critical evaluation sense? Certain kind of an international banks like SoftBank, located in Japan. This is one classic example. SoftBank, which is located in Japan, is providing the loan to the automobile companies who work for the eco-friendly technology. So now government of India need to channelize the fund from the SoftBank and other multinational banks in order to promote the electrical vehicle technology in our country. They are ready to offer the loan only to the eco-friendly technology. So now the government of India need to channelize this kind of a fund. So now rather than depending with the Indian bank, they can depend with respect to foreign banks also. In this entire second point, we are spoken in the aspect of economics. First point, we are spoken in the aspect of environment. Second point, we are spoken in the aspect of economics. Third, with respect to the e-vehicles, variety of batteries is being available. Among the different varieties of battery, lithium-ion battery is the most preferable one. Lithium-ion battery is the most preferable one. The reason is that volumetric capacity, gravitational capacity, volumetric capacity is more, gravitational capacity is more, discharging time. Most important factor is discharging time. Discharging time is least. So based upon this, even though we are blessed with plenty of batteries, lithium-ion battery is the most preferable one. Positive. But where comes the negative in sense? The scope for producing lithium-ion battery in a domestic manner is a challenging task. Scope for producing the lithium-ion batteries in the domestic sector is a challenging task. So if you can't able to produce this battery, the reason is that the entire vehicle 40 to 45% of the vehicle cost will be beared by the battery. 40 to 45% of the vehicle cost will be beared to the battery. In that case, rather than having a domestic production, simply if you are going to import this battery, in sense, vehicle cost will be too high. It won't be an affordable price. So that's a negative. What can be an evaluation? Go with respect to the recent budget, 2019 budget. What they are given? Investment linked eco-friendly business. Investment linked eco-friendly business will have a tax exception. So complete tax exception is given if you are going to promote eco-friendly technology. So positive, negative, along with an evaluation is there. So now the companies and the startups who is planning to promote the eco-friendly technology can be focused with respect to the government initiative. So complete tax exception is being given. So positive, negative, along with an evaluation. The third point we have spoken in the aspect of science. Fourth. The Bloomberg Finance report says that the domestic production is getting increased, then the cost of electrical vehicles would be cheaper in Indian market when compared to the other countries in the world. This is the report is saying. So whenever you are quoting setting it up a thing, the production is getting less or the other things is getting cheaper, Naga, you need to quote from where you had been taking these kind of inferences. So now, electrical vehicles, what is the meaning conveyed over here? This electrical vehicles would be cheaper in India when compared to the other companies, other countries in the world. The reason is that increase with the domestic production. So now what happened in sense, vehicles is cheaper. Whether it will be in an affordable condition in sense, with respect to India, the affordable cap with respect to India, if you are looking with respect to the per capita income is very less, so that the electrical vehicles won't be an affordable portion for the public to purchase it. They can able to ready to purchase with respect to the other vehicles, but at the same time what happens is the per capita income is less. So now at the rate of the per capita income, they won't be in a condition of affordable range. The affordability need to be compared with respect to the per capita income. By comparing, you can able to say that what's there in the negative. Further, what is an evaluation given over here? What is the GST for the electrical vehicles? 12%. 12% is the GST. On the other hand, if you're moving for the luxurious vehicles, for the petroleum and diesel vehicles, what is the GST? 43%. And you don't have a sales charge. Suppose if you are purchasing an electrical vehicle and you are going to involve in a commercial business, as a matter of promoting the commercial business, you need to move towards multiple states in the country. So here, government had offered, in order to promote commercial business via electrical vehicles, national permit will be given at free of cost. The fourth point we are addressing in the form of socio-economic condition. Political condition, let us go with respect to political. In the aspect of a political condition, in order to meet the, we can able to have a synergize national polar mission. We can synergize with the national solar mission. What is the target we have as per the national solar mission by 2022? 100 gigawatt. In order to meet this condition, what can be recommended in sense? Electric vehicles batteries can be used for trapping the solar energy. So rather than depending with the commercial power, they can able to depend with respect to solar energy for their recharging. Positive. So what is the negative over here in sense? The negative is there in the form of infrastructure, lack of infrastructure. So what is that infrastructure is required? Integration of power obtained from the renewable energy resources to the national grid is the infrastructure required. So you can have the plenty of renewable energy resources. Those kind of a power obtained from the renewable energy resources need to be interconnected with respect to the national grid. Do we have any such a kind of an infrastructure? Right now we are lacking with the infrastructure. What is the scope? What is an evaluation? In order to fasten the green energy corridor project. We are fastening the green energy corridor project. Already we have kickstarted this project. It is happening, but not yet completed. We are estimated to complete with respect to this project by 2018. But unfortunately, it takes about some 3 more years. So this project aims to interconnect the renewable energy resources with respect to the renewable power obtained from renewable energy resources with the national grid. So this fifth point is addressed in the aspect of political. That's it. So almost in the question you can able to find the diversification. Social point is there, technical point is there, political point is there, socio-economic is there. Further, if you want to speak in the aspect of commercialization, commerce point also you can able to take as a matter of addressing with the FAME India scheme, which aims to provide employment opportunities. There you can able to connect with respect to the green transport urban scheme. What's the objective behind the green transport urban scheme? Even I can present it, but page won't be there. Sixth, in the aspect of commerce, you can able to speak with respect to the FAME India scheme, as well as with respect to the National Automobile Policy 2026, which aims to provide 65 million job opportunities only in the EV sectors. Positive is there. A negative as well as with respect to evaluation can be touched with respect to the green urban transport scheme. One among the desired objective mentioned under this green urban transport scheme is that it comes under the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, which aims to construct e-highways. And recently Ministry of Road Transport announced India is going to have the first e-highways, which will be running from Mumbai to Delhi. Still, if you have some amount of page to be left out, even you can able to extend your answer in the next dimension in the form of commerce. That's it. The next question with respect to the cyber physical systems. Cyber physical systems. So what is cyber physical system? Any idea? Interconnecting of three technologies, interlinking of three famous technologies known as cyber physical system. What are those three technologies? It's interconnection of IoT with big data. Yes, AI is also there. Big data along with AI. In general, CPS is claimed to be called as 3C technology. What are those 3C stands for? Computational, communication, cognition. Computation will be related to big data, communication will be related to IoT, cognition will be related to AI. So for this question, what they are asking is, what is cyber physical system? This explanation is more than enough. Suppose if the question is being something different, explain cyber physical system in sense. Here need not to go for an explanation. You know, this information is more than enough. Suppose if the question is an explanation in sense, you need to speak about the five levels. Not recommended for this question, but in future try to know that five levels is there with respect to the cyber physical system. What are the five levels in sense? Smart connectivity level. Second, data to information conversion level, cyber level. Fourth, cognitive level. Fifth, self configuration level. Five levels. So you can use these levels. If the question seems to be in the form of explain, the question seems to be explain the cyber physical system sense, you can't able to do it, you need to go with the five levels. So here we don't have this word explain, simply what is cyber physical system. Okay. Further, we need to speak about the national mission of interdisciplinary cyber physical system. So what is the first thing said under the National Mission on Interdisciplinary Cyber Physical System? It aims to establish 15 கேள்வி பட்டீங்களா இல்லீங்களா டெக்னாலஜிக்கல் இன்னோவேஷன் ஹப். இட் எய்ம்ஸ் டு எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ் 6 அப்ளிகேஷன் இன்னோவேஷன் ஹப் அண்ட் 4 டெக்னாலஜி டிரான்ஸ்லேஷன் Research Park. And scope is given in the aspect of technological development, skill development, business development. International collaborations. So these are the four scopes what we have under the National Mission on Interdisciplinary Cyber Physical System. So first we are saying about what is cyber physical system. Two lines is more than enough. And slightly we need to touch about the National Mission on Interdisciplinary Cyber Physical System. Simply if you are speaking about these four to five points is more than enough. So hardly half of the page will be getting over. Still we have the presence of some amount of pages. So 1.5 pages will be there. In that case, where we can able to use instance, we can able to speak about the challenges and opportunities which is kept in front of this cyber physical system in Indian society. So what is the opportunity? When you come for opportunity, you can able to go with the sector based opportunities. The agriculture sector, you can use CPS. Where you can able to have the presence of CPS, first of all, then only we can able to go for the opportunities. Wherever you have the condition to meet with the feedback loop mechanism. Wherever you have setting up an application, the application need to have a feedback loop based operation. So wherever you are expecting with the feedback loop based mechanism, there you can able to go with the application of CPS. Even with respect to the filling of our overhead tank, it's a kind of a feedback loop mechanism. So once the tank is getting empty, motor need to be getting turned on. Once the tank is getting completely filled, motor need to be getting turned off. Like that, wherever you have a scope for implementing the feedback loop mechanism, there you can able to suggest for the CPS. The thing is getting clear. So now in case of an agriculture, you can able to go for the precision farming. So plenty of technique is there with the precision farming. Whichever is comfortable, you can able to go for that. Second, with respect to the transportation, automatic traffic control system going to be there in India by 2025. Source, Ministry of Road Transport. Third, with respect to energy sector, smart meters. Whether it came into life, Even in Chennai T Nagar, we have the presence of smart meters. Already the test trial is happening. Go for the implementing CPS for the energy sector, health sector. Precision diagnostics and treatment. You can have a regular monitoring condition of the patient. The patient might be present in some remote location. Doctor might be there in the urban area. Without having a physical contact with the doctor and the patient, now the doctor can able to monitor the condition of the patient on a timely basis. So precision diagnosis and treatment will be there. Like that, we have plenty of scope, so you can able to go with the sector-based approach. And next thing what we have under this question is that challenges. What would be the primary challenge? Since all the three technologies getting interconnected, definitely one challenge you can able to contribute. Data leakage. Data leakage is happening, it gives a question mark for privacy. Further, the second thing is that computational arbitrations. So what is computational arbitration sense? Before having the connectivity of three technology, first of all, the technology need to observe what is happening in the physical condition. If you want to develop certain kind of CPS in order to regulate the operation of AC in this room, in sense, first it need to sense what is its temperature, what is the current temperature that we have in India, because the temperature what we have in India won't be similar to the other countries. So it need to sense with respect to global parameters. It need to sense with respect to regional parameters rather than focusing with the global parameters. So now, computational arbitration is the next challenge. We don't have a uniform range of distribution of temperature throughout our whole country. So that comes the second task. Third, technological barrier. So what is required for CPS instance? We need to have an ad hoc networking system. We need to have an exclusive ad hoc networking system for the CPS. Fourth, it comes in the form of consistency. So what you can able to address for the consistency instance, the data speed, power source. Fifth problem arises in the form of human interaction. The inside a home where you won't have such a kind of abnormality with the human being interaction. But if you're opening for the doors for a large scale areas, application of CPS in the roadside for automatic traffic control system, application of CPS in the battlefield, there we'll be having more amount of human being intervention. So if you are applying this kind of technology in the battlefield, first you need to identify whether the person who is standing in front of the system is a kind of an enemy or he is a kind of a friend. Otherwise, what will happen in sense, automatic firing will be happening. There comes a huge question mark for the military ethics. So like that, these are the challenges, like plenty of challenges there, nearly about some 10 challenges there. You need to go for all the 10, 5 is more than enough. Next, proton therapy. Proton therapy versus what is the current treatment we are having? Conventional therapy, X-ray. Okay, so you have to go for comparative analysis. Just explain your concept in a correlated manner. So proton therapy, what is happening in sense, we send only the proton beams. But over here we send pulses of X-rays. Proton therapy, why we need to speak about this therapy first of all? Any significant feature is there? Putting it? Are the immunotherapy Nobel Prize? Proton therapy Nobel Prize illa. Exactly. India's first proton therapy center came into life in Chennai Apollo Hospital. Only 16 countries in the world is having this proton therapy. India is one among the 16 countries to have this technology. And the inauguration was given by our vice president. So we can't able to consider as a simple news. It should be a kind of a special news. Since we are one among the country to have this technology, And along with the inauguration was done by the Vice President, it's a special news. Okay. So proton beams will be used there, we will be using with the X-rays. So since the proton beams is used, how the approach will be there? And since approach will be there in the form of targeted approach. Here we will be having the generalized approach. Generalized approach. In case of a targeted approach, which cells alone will be getting targeted? Since only the cancer cells alone will be getting targeted. But over there, cancer cells along with the healthier cells. Both will be getting targeted. And next, in case of a proton therapy, what won't be witnessed in sense, in case of proton therapy, apart from the cancer cell, it won't attack the other healthier cells. You need to contribute the reasons. The reason is that it follows a technique which is called as a Bragg's curve technique. Means that if you have a cancer cell, the proton beam will be projected towards a cancer cell. It will be targeting the particular site which is present, the tumor site. And even after penetrating into the cell, it won't come outside. So since it is not coming outside, along with the Bragg's curve technique, one more point also you can generate. What is it generating in the sense? No exit drug condition. So it will penetrate into the cancer cell. Even after having penetration into the cancer cell, it won't come outside. But over here, in case of an X-ray technique, we don't have this technique. No curve-based techniques, as well as exit radiation will be more. In case of proton therapy, you won't have the possibility to develop the secondary cancers. So when we'll be supposed to have the secondary cancer? After the treatment. After the treatment, under the proton therapy, possibility to have a secondary cancer is not there. But in case of an X-ray treatment, possibility is there to have the development of secondary cancers. So almost this will be consuming about some 1 pages. The rest of the page you can able to deal with respect to the another treatment which is mentioned in the question. The name is immunotherapy. The reason to have this immunotherapy is that Nobel Prize was awarded. The same X-ray therapy you can use with respect to the previous point what we have spoken, but I can able to substantiate some point for the immunotherapy. X-ray therapy need not repeat once again. So what is happening in the immunotherapy? Under the immunotherapy, it aims to boost our own immune system. It boosts our own immune system. How our own immune system is getting boosted in sense? As a matter of activating the T cells. So once this T cells is getting activated, what will happen since T cells is capable to bind the unwanted antigens. Capable to bind the unwanted antigens. Now when it comes for a treatment, from the particular patient's body itself, you can able to take the antigens from his cancer cells. Antigen will be taken from cancer cells. And this antigen will be having a co-stimulation. Will have a co-stimulation with the T cells. So once it is going to have a co-stimulation with the T cells, now what happened? All the cancer cells which is present in your body will be getting destroyed by our own immune system. What is an estimated value in sense? Single T cell will be in a position to destroy 10 lakh cancer cells. Single T cell will be in a position to destroy 10 lakh cancer cells. The T cells is a kind of a immune cell what we have from the lymphatic nodes. Further, on the other hand, if cancer cell is trying to attack the T cells, we need to have the precautionary step also. So during the type of during the time of treatment itself, the doctor will be advising the patient to intake immune inhibitors. These immune inhibitors will protect the T cells from the attacking of the cancer cells. So now, who is possible to have a destruction sense? Only our T cells is capable to destroy the cancer cells. In return, cancer cells won't be in a position to attack and destroy our T cells. The reason is that protection is given in the form of immune inhibitors. Some protein drug will be given. That protein drug will act as an inhibitor. So what is the major advantage over here? Radiation is not required. Radiation is not required. 100% cure will be there. Even with the proton technique also, we can't be able to expect for 100% curing. But here, 100% curing will be there. The reason is that treatment is given simply by boosting our own immune system. 100% curing is there. And third, no artificial drugs. Even the protein inhibitor is taken from his own body. And the treatment won't be a kind of a prolonged period of treatment. Treatment will be there for about 10 to 15 days. Hospitalization is required only for about 10 to 15 days. Instead of if you are going for a radiation technique in sense, for a regular time period, you need to administer for the radiation. But here, 10 to 15 days is more than enough. But initial investment cost, since the technology is new, initial investment will be more. But once it is getting flourished, the rate of cost will be much more cheaper when compared to the other techniques. That's it. Thank you.